Good morning. The Subcommittee on Human Resources and Intergovernmental Relations is now in session. Today, the Subcommittee continues its review of federal studies of Agent Orange, the toxic herbicide used in Vietnam. Last year, we conducted a hearing on the Agent Orange exposure study designed by the Centers for Disease Control. That study was canceled in 1987 because, CDC claimed, it was scientifically impossible to determine exposure to Agent Orange. After that hearing, I concluded that the CDC study was so poorly conducted that it had either been botched or rigged. Since then, a great deal has happened, some of it encouraging news for Vietnam veterans, but much of it still discouraging. The subcommittee obtained the records of the White House Agent Orange Working Group. Those records are an important part of a report I will soon recommend for approval to the subcommittee and full committee. Last January, CDC issued a long-awaited selected cancer study which showed Vietnam veterans to be at significantly greater risk of contracting non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. Based on that finding, the Secretary of Veterans Affairs decided to compensate Vietnam veterans who have non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, although the Secretary did not directly link the disease to Agent Orange. A month ago, Admiral Elmo Zumwalt, who will testify today, issued a report linking Agent Orange with a wide range of deadly diseases and asked that the Department of Veterans Affairs compensate Vietnam veterans suffering from the various illnesses. Based on Admiral Zumwalt's recommendation, the Secretary of Veterans Affairs added another rare cancer, soft tissue sarcoma, as a compensable disease, but again, did not formally link it to Agent Orange exposure. That's the good news. The bad news is that the federal government continues to insist that Agent Orange exposure cannot be assessed, despite evidence to the contrary. And the Department of Veterans Affairs continues to deny the vast majority of more than 30,000 claims by veterans with diseases associated with dioxin, the chemical contaminant in Agent Orange. We will hear testimony again today about Agent Orange. We will also hear testimony about the toxic effects of other herbicides, which are used regularly in the United States by everyone from farmers to homeowners. These herbicides contain contaminants related to dioxin. The effects of these poisons may be important in determining the consequences of Agent Orange exposure. Other herbicides, many of which are regularly used in the U.S., may be just as deadly, if not more so. We will hear about some of those herbicides today, perhaps for the first time in connection with Agent Orange. Finally, the subcommittee will review allegations of bias in the review of studies conducted by the Department of Veterans Affairs Advisory Committee on Environmental Hazards. I must say that the testimony that we're about to get, I find extremely shocking. It is one thing to ask Americans to go into battle and to risk life and limb. It's another thing to then, after they've done that and suffered either directly or indirectly from the military situation they found themselves in, to deny them the compensation for injuries or illnesses which they contracted. The testimony which we're about to receive today will again demonstrate that there has been a shocking determination to deny compensation and to deny scientific evidence, not because the evidence was not there, but because the White House was afraid of what it would cost to compensate veterans who risked their lives for this country. Beyond that, we will be hearing testimony which will indicate that the cover-up of the effects of dioxin and dioxin-related contaminants, in fact, has gone beyond just the military and has gone into the civilian sector as well, so that not only veterans and their families have cause to be concerned, but all Americans have cause to be concerned. When they began to contract illnesses from their exposure to Agent Orange, Vietnam veterans sought compensation for their suffering. They asked for justice, but instead had their claims rejected and had scientific studies of their illnesses manipulated by White House officials on a mission to reduce government spending. This is the ultimate affront to the brave men and women who died in combat on foreign soil and who die yet today from their exposure to toxic chemicals two decades ago. Before we call our first witness, let me indicate what this morning's schedule will be. As you know, this is a very exciting day on Capitol Hill. Nelson Mandela will be addressing a joint session of Congress at 11 o'clock. We will continue our hearing until 11:15. At that time, we will take a recess, and we will resume the hearing within 15 minutes after the joint session has concluded. I expect that to be somewhere around 12 or 12:15 at the latest, and we will then conclude our hearings. Our first witness will be a distinguished American who has devoted his life to the service of his country, Admiral Elmo Zumwalt. Admiral, we're proud to have you with us today. As you know, the procedures of the Government Operations Committee is that our witnesses are all sworn in, so if you would, sir, stand, raise your right hand. You swear or affirm that the testimony you're about to give will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth.
I do.
Thank you. What we've asked all of our witnesses to do today is to try to condense their testimony to no more than 10 minutes so that we can, in fact, conclude the hearing with everyone getting a chance to testify and to respond to some questions if we have any. And with that, we have your prepared statement, which, of course, will be entered into the record without objection in its entirety, and you may proceed as you deem appropriate.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Admiral, that microphone is not very sensitive, so you have to bring it rather close to yourself. Good.
I have here today in the room Mr. Phil Friedman of Ross and Hardy's, who helped me prepare this study, and as did Dr. Gene Stellman, Dr. Ellen Silbergold, Dr. Peter Kahn, all in this room. They're some of the 10 or 15 scientists who worked with me. As many of you know, it's been my special assignment over the past several months at the direction of Secretary Dewinsky of the Department of Veterans Affairs to undertake an extensive review of the available scientific literature that speaks to the human health effects associated with exposure to the contaminants found in Agent Orange. In a report filed with the Secretary on May 5, 1990, a copy of which I am submitting for the record of these proceedings, I set forth in some detail, A, the results of my assessment of the health impacts that credited medical and scientific studies are indicating can be linked to exposures to dioxin contaminants found in Agent Orange, B, the probable association of those exposures with cancers and other debilitating illnesses, including birth defects, and C, how the weight of studied literature required the conclusion that a significant number of adverse health effects suffered by Vietnam veterans are more likely than not associated with service-related exposure to Agent Orange. Let me start by stating that there's an overwhelming body of credited scientific research supporting the conclusion that certain cancers and other illnesses are associated with exposure to Agent Orange. Tragically, there is also credible evidence strongly suggesting that the probable cause of birth defects among children of Vietnam veterans can be traced to their parents' exposure to Agent Orange. The committee should take note that I do not appear before you alone in my views. The 27 health effects that I list in my report closely parallel the recently released findings of the Agent Orange Scientific Task Force. This group of seven independent and prominent scientists assembled by various veterans groups also evaluated the available scientific literature and concluded on their own that 21 health effects are associated with exposure to Agent Orange. It is indeed a fair observation that any objective review of the available scientific literature by knowledgeable experts will predictably lead to much the same conclusion. When I began the formidable task assigned to me by Secretary Dewinsky, I hoped against hope that I would not find a discernible association between illnesses experienced by Vietnam veterans and exposure to Agent Orange. For one, I accepted Secretary Dewinsky's assignment out of a keen awareness that from 1970 to 74, as commander of naval forces in Vietnam, I approved of and ordered the extensive spraying of Agent Orange as a proven means of reducing combat casualties. Secondly, while my son Elmo and I frequently suspected that his suffering and eventual death from both Hodgkin's and non-Hodgkin's lymphoma were related to his wartime exposure to Agent Orange, both he and I believed, as did many others, that there was insufficient scientific evidence to support a linkage between his illnesses and Agent Orange exposure. That was, of course, the conventional propaganda of the time. The sad truth which emerges from my work is not only that there is credible evidence linking certain cancers and other illnesses with Agent Orange, but that the government and industry officials credited with examining such linkage intentionally manipulated or withheld compelling information on the adverse health effects associated with exposure to the toxic contaminants contained in Agent Orange. As my report documents, the efforts to distort the record of the health effects of Agent Orange were so appallingly egregious that they continue to needlessly muddle the debate on the human health effects of toxic dioxins. In my statement, I then go into detail on the fraudulent production of both the government studies and the chemical company studies. The second group of the disproportionate impact of these studies is overriding all of my conclusions. What is so incredible about the revelations associated with Agent Orange is that the flawed scientific studies and manipulated conclusions are not only unduly denying justice to Vietnam veterans suffering from exposure to Agent Orange, they are now standing in the way of a full disclosure to the American people of the likely health effects of exposure to toxic dioxins. Consider that Dr. Vernon Houck, a member of the White House Agent Orange Working Group and the current director of the Center for Environmental Health and Injury Control, recently recommended that a state government adopt dioxin dumping standards for paper mills at a level 50 times greater than that recommended by the EPA. Astoundingly, Dr. Houck's letter comes even in the face of the EPA's own warning that the presence of such a potent carcinogen as dioxin in the production of paper warrants greater concern, attention, and regulatory action. This, remember, is coming from the director of the very department within the CDC responsible for the Agent Orange studies that I've covered. For those cynics who remain, consider further that military applications of Agent Orange were dropped in concentrations 6 to 25 times greater than considered at the time safe for human use. In light of the fact that developing scientific and medical expertise continues to verify that dioxin is a potent carcinogen, and that we now know from the field of immunology that dioxin, through immunosuppression, indirectly facilitates the spread of cancer, there is more than enough evidence to give the Vietnam veteran exposed to Agent Orange the benefit of the doubt, to the extent doubting Thomas's remain. On his compensation claim for service-related cancers, birth defects, and other illnesses listed in my report, to his credit, Secretary Dewinsky, with the personal support of the President, has honorably distanced himself from the Agent Orange fraud. In an attentive, thoughtful, and compassionate decision, Secretary Dewinsky recently concluded that soft tissue sarcoma is a compensable service related injury directly associated with a veteran's exposure to Agent Orange. This comes on the heels of an earlier decision to recognize non-Hodgkin's lymphoma as a compensable injury. While these are landmark decisions in the sordid Agent Orange affair, they are only the first steps in righting a significant national wrong committed against our Vietnam veterans. As documented in my report, the Agent Orange Scientific Task Force report and numerous other studies that speak to the serious health risks associated with exposure to the contaminants found in Agent Orange, there is more than enough verifiable, credible evidence to justify service-connected compensation for Vietnam veterans exposed to Agent Orange. The debate on this matter has been needlessly prolonged. The right decision, indeed the only morally acceptable decision for members of this committee and their colleagues in Congress, is to acknowledge that Agent Orange is responsible for a wide range of diseases, illnesses, and birth defects for which the Vietnam veteran should be rightfully compensated. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much, Admiral Grunwald, and you notice that your timing was impeccable. The red light went on just as you uttered your last words. You've recommended that the Department of Veterans Affairs compensate Vietnam veterans for 27 different illnesses. Yet until only 3 months ago, the department refused to compensate veterans for any disease related to Agent Orange other than chloracne. Why has the government been ignoring evidence linking Agent Orange exposure to diseases?
The problem, Mr. Chairman, has been that there has been manipulation of the studies done by the government. In my statement, I document at great length and in the report at greater length the extent of the manipulations of both the ranch hand work and the Centers for Disease Control studies. These studies are, in my judgment, absolutely without merit, to the extent that they have been used to presume negative findings. In the case of the ranch hand study, the power is too low. The National Academy of Science, in its preliminary reviews of the protocol, said that the power was too low. And nevertheless, there have been suggestive positive findings in spite of the power that have been withheld from the public. And the conclusions have been manipulated from one that were not reassuring to one that asserted that the conclusions were reassuring. Similarly, with regard to the Centers for Disease Control studies, once the Agent Orange study was not done as a result of fraudulent conclusions about the capability to place company positions, and therefore sticking to battalion positions, which succeeded in diluting the numbers who were exposed. Once the conclusion was made not to complete that study, then there was absolutely no excuse for going forward with the selected cancer study, which was to have been based upon the identification of those who had been exposed. And the then to report the selected cancer study out as one that in any way was negative with regard to Agent Orange was another fraud perpetrated on the public.
You use the word fraud, so that you're suggesting that this was not just a misjudgment or a study that went bad by accident or coincidence, but that in fact this was a deliberate effort.
That is my strong conclusion. I believe that Dr. Vernon Houck, who heads that one division of the Centers for Disease Control, which lacks the superb excellence of the other six divisions, has made it his mission to manipulate and prevent the true facts from being determined. I think it's absolutely unbelievable that he would have recommended to a state agency that the dioxin dumping standard be increased by a factor of 50.
Last Friday, the subcommittee received a draft copy of the Air Force Ranch Hand study of birth defects. Ranch Hand is the name that was given to study of those group of people who were responsible for dumping the Agent Orange toxic material out of the airplanes. Although the preliminary findings indicated that Ranch Hand personnel were at higher risk of fathering offspring with birth defects after Vietnam service, the study has not been completed. Would the birth defects findings be significant in determining compensation for Vietnam veterans exposed to Agent Orange?
They would, and I think it is absolutely shocking that it took a threatened subpoena from this committee to get that study released after the Air Force had refused to release it on the personal request of Senator Daschle and others for many years. I think it does show, in spite of the fact that it is a low-power study, that there is a very strong presumption that birth defects have been caused by exposure to Agent Orange. And the failure to complete that study, when it was, we were told at the time in 1984 that it would take only an additional 12 months to do so, the failure to find the true exposure index for the individuals in that study can, in my judgment, only be judged as contributing to a decision to not disclose the facts about the harmful effects of Agent Orange. And it, for that reason, makes me very concerned about the forthcoming Air Force study on birth defects, which I think should be viewed with great suspicion, and I believe should be independently evaluated going right down to the raw data by experts brought in by your committee or another branch of government.
You've concluded that the Advisory Committee on Environmental Hazards was biased in its review of Agent Orange. Have you identified the reason for this bias?
Yes, sir, and in my report, I go to some considerable length to show the extent to which respected scientists have found fault with the procedures of that study. And in my first statement to the committee, when I appeared with them at my first meeting, I'm now on that Committee of Environmental Hazards, I went into great length there with what I thought were wrong with their procedures. I having sat through one of those meetings, have respect for a number of the members of that committee, but I continue to hold my belief that their procedures are badly flawed and that there are several on that committee who have distinct biases against any finding of a correlation between Agent Orange and health effects.
Does the Monsanto Corporation manufacture herbicides?
Yes, sir, it does.
Has the advisory committee relied on research prepared by Monsanto scientists, Zach and Gaffey, in its investigation of the effects of Agent Orange?
It has. And I should add that it has also relied on another key reference study, the one done by the chemical company in Germany, BASF. In both cases, we now know, and my statement documents and my report documents, that the data that go into the studies that have flowed from The Monsanto explosion in 1949 and the German explosion in 1953 are fraudulent data. Yet they have for years been cited by epidemiologists as the basic reference studies. The EPA has considered that those are the only ones for which the data collected was precise enough and the latency period long enough that they could be used in that context. And they were cited, for example, by Michael Gow, who was formerly a member of the Agent Orange Working Group in the White House, as the basic reason for poo-pooing the results of other studies which show a very high correlation between exposure to dioxin and health effects. They have therefore performed a terrible disservice to the American and world public. These fraudulent studies being used as a basic reference have helped to cast doubt on the much more carefully done, honest studies that have followed.
When you say that the studies were proved to be fraudulent, what do you mean by that?
In the case of the Monsanto studies done by Zach and Gaffney and by Zach and Susskind, there is a document that I just read last night that breaks your heart. The deposition, or actually the court testimony of Dr. Rausch of Monsanto, who admits that these studies took people from the exposed group and called them unexposed and left cancer deaths from exposed people out, and that as a result, whereas the original study showed no correlation between exposure and health outcomes, the true outcomes were 65% more cancers overall. Similarly, with regard to the BASF studies, a Dr. Rohleder, hired by the German social court to examine the BASF company-supplied data, reported at a ninth symposium of on dioxin in Toronto last year that when you left out the 20 supervisory personnel that were fraudulently put in there as exposed, that you came out with cancers of the respiratory system 2.66 times as great as normal and cancers of the digestive system 2.55 times as great.
I have a few more questions, but before I go on, let me indicate that we've been joined by two of the distinguished members of this committee, the ranking Republican member, Mr. Army, and Mr. Smith of Vermont, and we're pleased to have them. And when you conclude your testimony, I'll recognize them for opening comments that they may have. In January, the Centers for Disease Control released a study on selected cancers in Vietnam veterans. Did you review the selected cancer study?
I did, Mr. Chairman.
The CDC found Vietnam veterans to be at increased risk of non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, but did not find any evidence that the increased risk was related to Agent Orange exposure. Did CDC attempt to measure Agent Orange exposure in the subjects of the selected cancer study?
No, they did not, and in my judgment, it was deliberately deceptive to infer in any way that the study told us anything about exposure to Agent Orange. What it did show, in spite of the CDC's best efforts to the contrary notwithstanding, is that even with all of the dilution of exposure to Agent Orange by examining all Vietnam veterans, not all of whom were exposed, you still found a 50% greater occurrence of non-Hodgkin's. They pretended as though the negative findings with regard to other cancers were meaningful, whereas in fact the power for those cancers was so low that it's ridiculous that they should even have referred to them.
A 1988 Veterans Administration study comparing Marine and Army veterans of Vietnam found that the Marines serving in I Corps were at greater risk of contracting non-Hodgkin's lymphoma and lung cancer. The director of the VA's Office of Environmental Medicine testified before this subcommittee last year that there was no significance to these findings. Do you agree with that conclusion?
No, sir. That's another one of the fraudulent things that the CDC has done. They keep referring to the III Corps and the fact that the Army results were not as great as suggesting that there's something unusual and to be disregarded with regard to the findings up in I Corps. Every source that we examine shows higher occurrences in I Corps. The Veteran Administration's own study comparing Marines who went to Vietnam with those who did not showed 110% more non-Hodgkin's lymphoma and 57% more lung cancer among those Marines. Now, the CDC made no effort whatsoever to come up with a logical explanation. Had they talked to anyone who understood the Vietnam situation, the explanation is very logical as to why the Marines would show higher than the Army. In the I Corps, all of the logistics were provided by the U.S. Navy, and those Navy personnel were corresponding to the Army logistics personnel down in III Corps who were not exposed. But since the Navy was not examined, and only the Marines out in the jungles were examined, the data properly showed much higher. That group was, on the average, much more highly exposed, because in the Army case, they were diluted by their based logistics personnel. Furthermore, in the I Corps, the Marines had a quite different system for fighting the war. For great periods of time, they went out into the villages and stayed there and tried to introduce the hearts and minds of the people to democratic ways, whereas the Army went in, went back to base, took showers, went in, went back to base, took showers. The Marines living in those villages, eating the food, drinking the water, not getting the showers, were much more highly exposed. So it's a perfectly logical explanation that the CDC chose to disregard.
Although the Secretary of Veterans Affairs has agreed to compensate veterans for non-Hodgkin's lymphoma and soft tissue sarcoma, there are dozens of other diseases you recommended for compensation status. Has the Secretary given you any indication about whether he will accept your other recommendations?
No, sir. He has indicated that he appreciated the study and that he thought it had a contribution with regard to his determination on soft tissue sarcoma. As I indicated in my earlier comments, I think he is the first head of the veterans who has truly and objectively tried to get at the data. His problem is that he has inherited a committee which is using flawed procedures, some of whose members are biased, and a procedure which is mechanistic and takes a very long time to work through. These new data have not yet been examined with regard to the many other health effects that must be examined. I am of the view that the only way you're really going to get at this quickly and to eliminate the long travail for the veterans is for the Congress to enact legislation that provides service connection compensation for all of these health effects. Short of that, I believe that it's incumbent upon the Congress to subpoena the data from those chemical companies within its purview and to subpoena the witnesses as witnesses under oath, the people who prepared those studies, and to create a record of the fraudulent nature of all the studies so that epidemiologists can begin to discard those as reference studies and pay attention only to the honest ones that have been done.
When the military stopped spraying Agent Orange in Vietnam, it did so because of the discovery that it contained harmful contaminants. Isn't it true that the United States government and the manufacturers of Agent Orange knew of the harmful effects of Agent Orange long before the spraying stopped?
Yes, sir. There's absolutely no question that they knew about it. On page 6 of my report, for example, I quote Dr. James McClary, who says, when we military scientists initiated the herbicide program in the 1960s, we were aware of the potential for damage due to dioxin contamination in the herbicide. We were even aware that the military formulation had a higher dioxin concentration than the civilian version due to the lower cost and speed of manufacture. However, because it was to be used on an enemy, none of us were overly concerned. We never considered a scenario in which our own personnel would become contaminated. And if we had, we would have expected our government to give assistance to veterans so contaminated. I have examined files from the Dow Chemical Company provided to me through the Canadian system, which was able to get them without a hold on them, that show that they were concerned about dioxin as early as 1961.
We're going to be asking our next panel about commercial herbicides, but I understand that your research has discovered that there may be carcinogenic materials in 2,4-D, a chemical prevalent in herbicides. Is that correct?
Yes, sir. Dr. Tiedelbaum, who is here and I believe will be testifying, can give this evidence firsthand. But in my report, I quote a letter from him which cites his discovery of heretofore unreleased information about contaminants in the 2,4-D that had never been disclosed.
Based on your concerns, did you ask the Environmental Protection Agency to consider an emergency suspension of the use of 2,4-D?
Yes, sir, I did. I wrote a letter a copy of which I can give the committee, to Douglas Camp, who is the director of the Office of Pesticide Programs in the EPA, attaching copies of two documents which aver that the Dow Chemical Company has never informed EPA or any other government agency of significant concentrations of carcinogenic materials in 2,4-D, and said that they ought to investigate. That was only sent on 8 June, however. So
have you received a response from them?
I have not, and I'm just sure that as soon as the chemical companies hear about it, that there'll be all kinds of pressure brought to bear on EPA, as there has been in the past.
Do you believe that United States citizens are adequately protected from the harmful effects of herbicides in use today?
I do not. I believe that there has been a scandalous failure on the part of all members of Congress and the executive branch who are concerned with these issues to have nailed down the extent to which the fraudulent data provided by the chemical companies has made this country far less passive, far more passive than it should be, about the poisons being secreted. The study done by the University of Kansas and the National Cancer Institute a couple of years ago, examining Kansas farmers who had used 2,4-D as a pesticide and compared them to a control group who had not, found 6 to 8 times as many non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. And a subsequent study in Nebraska came up with similar conclusions. We know that we're poisoning our people.
I'm going to yield now to my colleagues. Before I do so, let me repeat what I said about our schedule this morning. We're going to recess the subcommittee at 10:45 so that we can all attend the joint session with Mr. Mandela. And then we will resume in about 15 minutes after the joint session concludes, and I figure that should be about somewhere around 12:15. And at this point, then, I'm pleased to recognize our distinguished ranking member, Mr. Army.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I first of all, let me thank you for holding these hearings. It's a very important subject matter, and I hope that we will gain some insight and understanding. I want to thank you, Admiral Zumwalt, for your testimony this morning, as well as your service to this country over a long period of time. I might ask consent, Mr. Chairman, that my formal remarks be put in the record.
Without objection, that will be done.
And I would like to ask unanimous consent that all members be allowed to submit questions in writing to our witnesses.
Without objection, that.
And with that, I will go ahead and give back the rest of my time. We can get on with the hearings.
Good. Thank you very much, Mr. Army. Mr. Smith?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and Admiral. I have a question, but before I ask it, I would associate myself with what my colleague, Mr. Army, has said, and like to thank you for not only your service to this country, but also your continued service to this country. Service takes on many forms, and oft times, and I think what is disturbing to me as a new member of this Congress and this committee is that it is after men and women have left their formal or recognized time of service that they are either able or able to say and do things, or for other reasons come to a point of realization where they are compelled to continue their service in other ways. And I think of the recent Iowa investigation where people who then found themselves out beyond their formal service were then able to turn around and say, in fact, the investigation bordered on fraudulent. And I see and hear you not only today, but I think the reason you're here today is that you, as you have moved beyond your formal service to this country, find that there is a less formal but equally compelling set of reasons to that call you, really, to try to bring onto the table and into public scrutiny data, facts, relationships, and consequences that heretofore have only been wondered at. And the burden of, I guess, my opening comment is that it has to be in the best interest of this country for issues such as the issues which surround the use of Agent Orange in Vietnam and the health issues which have plagued veterans since then, to remove them from the area of speculation. In other words, all over this country, all over my state of Vermont, when you sit down with Vietnam-era veterans, they believe in their hearts, and many of them have the anecdotes, but they're not scientists to prove, if you will, in non-scientific ways, that something terribly wrong happened. That then spreads out across the population, and so in barroom conversations and living room conversations and conversations amongst friends all over this country, you have speculation about what may or may not have happened, what the consequences may or may not be. And I would submit to this committee that is a form of a nightmare, that we owe people more than the right to speculate in a free society about what may or may not happen. We owe them a full report, and we owe them the truth, however painful or difficult that truth is for anybody to accept. I guess with that, you have used words that I think are all too common, and perhaps we hear them so much these days, whether it's with this institution's complicity and both parties with the SNL crisis or wherever else. You've used the word fraudulent repeatedly, even since I have come here. And I guess I want to pursue that and ask you to try to describe not the specifics of the fraud, but the nature of what you perceive to be or allege to be the fraudulent activity of the federal government in terms of hiding the truth about this specific issue of the use of Agent Orange and its health consequences on American servicemen and women. Are you suggesting that there was an active conspiracy, and we're now talking over the better part of two decades, I would say, so it's not one political party or another or one branch of government or another or anything else? It is big enough for everybody to take a piece of the responsibility here. Are you suggesting that there was an active conspiracy, and if so, could you describe its nature, or is it a passive conspiracy of acceptance, like the Ibsen play where the water was poisoned and no one wanted to talk about it because the town would lose business? Could you characterize it? Could you describe it? And could you help this freshman congressman figure out how to get a handle on it so that he can proceed with his interrogation over time?
Yes, sir. I believe it to have been active pursuit of manipulated or fraudulent results. I believe that, for example, there was a deliberate policy of not carrying out the original intent and proposal that there be veterans representation or scientists designated by veterans serving on the ranch hand study. That was never done. I believe that the ranch hand draft working report was withheld for 5 years and released only when this committee threatened to subpoena it, because it had information that shows that Vietnam veterans' children have twice the normal number of birth defects, twice the defects that those children born before Vietnam service had. I believe that the White House working group clearly instructed that there be a rewriting of the report that was released to eliminate a critical paragraph about health effects and to add the word reassuring results, whereas the original draft had said these definitely cannot be judged to be negative results. Similarly, with regard to the Centers for Disease Control, we know that Dr. Vernon Houck has been reported in this committee, has gone to great lengths not only to produce optimistic outcomes or meaningless outcomes by refusing to find out who was truly exposed in Vietnam, but has called up and tried to raise Cain with people who came out with different results, and has just recently signed a letter that ought to shock every American, recommending that the dioxin level approved for dumping be increased by a factor of 50. You have a very, very biased individual running that division.
So is it fair to say that from your point of view, that there is an active conspiracy that includes certain multinational corporations, multiple administrations, multiple sitting Congresses, and the CDC, at least?
One could never find a document that described that cabal. But we know, sir, that chemical companies spend lots of money both on public relations and on legislative relations, and they're lobbyists are all over town. They've had articles printed trying to denigrate my recent study. They're out trying to influence their congressmen and their senators, and telephone calls get made to the EPA and to the CDC, and that's the way the process works. It's the worst form of government ever invented, except for all the others that have been tried. And you and I both know, goes on.
I'm just learning. And I will tell you that this is an issue that started out as an academic issue with me as a candidate, and through this committee and other researches and readings I've done has become much more than that. And to me, the parallel that hits me in the face is that it is the chemical equivalent the chemical equivalent of the current SNL scandal.
There's no question about it. Except that this is much worse because lives are being lost.
Absolutely. It's hard for me to weigh which is worse when you're talking about the potential violation of public trust across the board and through time. And with that, I'll stop. But I thank you for your continued service to this country and to this committee.
Thank you very much, Mr. Smith. Admiral, again, you have the gratitude of this committee, and I would think the gratitude not only the veterans of this nation, but the people of this nation. I think you performed great public service on top of the great public service that you performed throughout your career. Thank you so much.
Thank you for calling this hearing, Mr. Chairman.
Our second panel is comprised of Dr. Arnold Schechter, Professor of Preventive Medicine, College of Medicine at Syracuse, SUNY, Dr. Sheila Hor Zam, Occupational Studies Section, Environmental Epidemiology Branch, Division of Cancer Etiology, National Cancer Institute, Dr. Daniel Thao Teitelbaum, President, Medical Toxicology Partnership, and Dr. Peter C. Kahn, Associate Professor of Biochemistry, Department of Biochemistry and Microbiology, Rutgers University. If you would all, before you sit down, just stand behind your nameplates. If you will all, each of you, raise your right hand. Do you swear or affirm that the testimony you're about to give will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
Yes.
Thank you. Let the record indicate that each of the witnesses has responded in the affirmative. Again, let me indicate to each of the witnesses that your prepared statements will be entered into the record in their entirety, and because of time constraints, we will have to enforce the 10-minute limitation, and hopefully you can summarize your testimony within that 10-minute limitation. Dr. Schechter, we'll begin with your testimony.
Thank you for the invitation to be here today. I'm a physician working with the Department of Preventive Medicine and Medical School in Binghamton, New York. Since 1984, I've worked extensively in Vietnam. Ironically, during the Vietnam War, I served as a member of the Army Medical Corps, but in Kentucky rather than Vietnam.
Dr. Schechter, that microphone is not very sensitive, so you'll have to speak up. We'll pull it a little bit closer to you.
The research which my colleagues and I have focused on since 1981 is the exposure estimate of people exposed to dioxins in Agent Orange. We've been measuring elevated dioxins in Vietnamese in Vietnam, in American Vietnam veterans, in nursing mothers in the United States, and in a number of work-related incidents. We found that in some American Vietnam veterans, the levels of dioxin from Agent Orange are elevated. In other American Vietnam veterans, this long after exposure, levels are lower. So we do have a sensitive and specific way to measure Agent Orange exposure. And I would point out, as I do in the printed material, that this is usually not employed in federal government studies. That is, the measurement of dioxins and dibenzofurans, which is available, and there is an excellent dioxin laboratory at the Centers for Disease Control, it is not being employed in the human health studies. We are looking in Vietnam because of the millions of people who now live in the exposed areas. And we are comparing dioxin levels in these people with American Vietnam veterans. I will leave this weekend for Vietnam in an attempt to collect blood from various areas where American veterans have served. We will be measuring the dioxins and matching these with dioxin levels in American veterans. The Vietnam government does have health studies underway which suggest that there are increases in cancers and increases in adverse reproductive outcome, malformed babies, spontaneous abortions, and fetal deaths in people living in the Agent Orange affected area at a higher rate than in other areas. The dioxin research in the United States done by the federal government is surprising to me also. The usual flaw which I find is that the measure of exposure is indirect. As a physician, I find this surprising. If a mother brings me her child or her children with possible lead exposure, I would take a medical history. I would do a physical examination, but I would also measure the blood lead level. I am at a loss to know why the federal government studies do not employ this way of estimating exposure. It's a powerful tool, it's a specific tool. It's been around since 1973, and it's not being used. The cost of doing this is between $1,000 and $2,000, very low by today's medical standards. And I think that to follow up on Admiral Zumwalt's very eloquent presentation, I would phrase the question differently. If someone says that he does not believe dioxins, dibenzofurans, PCBs, which are almost identical chemicals, cause human ill health effect, what data must be ignored? There's laboratory data, laboratory animals, wildlife data, massive rice oil poisoning with these chemicals in Japan in 1968 with about 2,000 ill patients, and a similar incident in 1979 in Taiwan. Again, there's a voluminous human clinical literature from Japan, from Taiwan, and from Vietnam relating to these chemicals. There is a literature on phenoxy herbicides, the names of Dr. Leonard Hardell from the medical school in Umeå, Sweden, and Dr. Sheila Harzam from the National Cancer Institute come immediately to mind with extraordinarily convincing human health studies relating to the phenoxy herbicides. I would recommend that in order to speed up this process of determining what amount of dioxins cause human illness, that studies in Vietnam take place, number one, to measure dioxin levels in the various areas where Agent Orange was sprayed. I will leave this weekend to conduct such studies, which are funded by foundations rather than federal government. This data will give us an indication as to where dioxins actually got into people from Agent Orange. Second, I would propose that health studies in Vietnam be considered in addition to parallel to American Vietnam veteran studies and studies of other exposed phenoxy herbicide exposed and dioxin exposed persons. The reason for this is in Vietnam, in the south of Vietnam, there is a population, 30 million people, with higher levels of dioxin from Agent Orange and from industry too, actually, than exists in the north of Vietnam. This is the only country in the world which I know of, based on World Health Organization studies, of which we participated, where there is a higher level of dioxins in the people in one part of the country and a lower level in others. In addition, the Vietnamese have lived in the Agent Orange sprayed areas since the spraying. They did not have one-year tours of duty or two-year tours of duty, so their exposure is higher. We need to parallel the American Vietnam veteran studies with Vietnamese in order to speed up the process of determining what level of dioxin is responsible for cancers, adverse reproductive outcome, neurologic damage, immune deficiency, and so on. It seems to me also reasonable at this time that for every Vietnam veteran who desires this, that fat tissue or blood be taken and analyzed for all measurable dioxins. If the work cannot be completed in a timely fashion, the fat or blood should be frozen and analyzed as soon as possible. This should not be done in isolation, but this should be done as part of a comprehensive medical evaluation for Agent Orange exposure. A person 20 years later may still have a low dioxin level and yet may have had exposure. So we should not use this to rule out exposure, but as just one tool in a medical armamentarium. It seems to me that some of the health studies that you've talked about earlier have a potential conflict of interest. We've done a good job in the United States with medical research. This is usually done at universities, medical schools, and schools of public health, in addition to federal agencies. The Agent Orange and dioxin research suffers, in my judgment, by a lack of university and medical school-based research, health research. I would propose that some of the research be done in medical schools, universities, and schools of public health in the traditional fashion in which American medical research has been performed. As a matter of humanitarian policy as well as science, it seems to me as a physician practicing and doing research in this field, and having done this since 1981, that it's time to compensate veterans and their family for those types of illnesses which have been found to occur from dioxins or dioxin-like chemicals, whether in animals or the rice oil poisoning incidents or the Vietnamese scientists' findings. You don't need to throw more money on medical research only to document what kind of illnesses we'll see. And I think we need to focus a little more on the nervous system damage and on reduction of the level of dioxins in exposed veterans and others, and male and female reproductive toxicity. Again, let me remind you that in 1973 to 74, Robert Bauchman and Matthew Messelson from Harvard University published the first findings of elevated dioxins in humans from breast milk from Agent Orange exposed women in Vietnam. These were among the highest findings reported until very recently, 1,400 parts per trillion of the dioxin characteristic of Agent Orange in the fatty part of these women's milk. The tools existed. We were using it in 81 through 83 in New York to measure exposed workers, elevated dioxins in fat and blood. Professor Rappe in Sweden, Masuda in Japan were measuring elevated dioxins. If you don't measure exposure properly in both those you think are exposed and the controls, you can't come up with correct conclusions about health consequences from these chemicals. Thank you for permitting me to be here. I'll enter this into the proceedings.
Good. Thank you very much, Dr. Schechter. Dr. Horzon?
My name is Sheila Horzom, and I'm an epidemiologist in the Epidemiology and Biostatistics Program, Division of Cancer Etiology at the National Cancer Institute. In my testimony today, I will review the epidemiologic research on herbicides that has been conducted at the NCI. Over the past decade, we have conducted an increasingly sophisticated series of epidemiologic studies of pesticide exposures, consisting of both insecticides and herbicides. These studies have included evaluation of geographic patterns of cancer mortality, investigations using death certificates, follow-up studies of pesticide applicators, and interview studies focusing on farming exposures. We have not conducted studies of Vietnam veterans or Agent Orange specifically, but the farming and pesticide applicator groups that we have studied have some herbicide exposures in common with the veterans. Two of the most relevant studies were conducted in the states of Kansas and Nebraska. These two studies had a case control design. Cases of cancer and a control group randomly selected persons without cancer from the general population, or if deceased, their next of kin, were interviewed concerning their past exposures. In the Kansas study, which was published in the Journal of the American Medical Association in 1986, we observed an excess risk of non-Hodgkin's lymphoma among herbicide users in comparison to non-farmers. Risk increased with the frequency of use to a six-fold increase in farmers who used herbicides 20 or more days per year. Use of the herbicide 2,4-D appeared to be responsible for the increase. Farmers who personally mixed or applied 2,4-D 20 or more days per year had an eight-fold increase in the incidence of non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. Risk was higher when the usual application method resulted in dermal or skin exposure. For example, farmers who usually used handheld or backpack sprayers had greater risk than farmers who typically used tractor-mounted sprayers. Use of protective equipment such as rubber gloves lowered risk to about the same level as that among farmers who had never used 2,4-D on their farms. In addition, farmers who did not personally mix or apply 2,4-D but had someone else apply the chemical on the farms had roughly the same risk as non-users. Likewise, there was no increased risk to others who lived or worked on the farms. It should also be noted that this study did not show an association between herbicides and soft tissue sarcoma or Hodgkin's disease. The report of the Nebraska study, which will be published in September in the peer-reviewed journal Epidemiology, shows results similar to the Kansas study. Farmers who used herbicides frequently had higher risk of non-Hodgkin's lymphoma than non-farmers. Risk again increased with frequency of use, but to a lesser degree than found in Kansas. It rose to a threefold increase among farmers who mixed or applied 2,4-D 20 or more days per year. This study demonstrated again the importance of dermal exposure. Risk increased the longer the farmers usually wore the clothing used during the pesticide spraying operations. If they usually changed their clothing right away, the 2,4-D users only had a 10% increased risk of non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. If they usually changed at the end of the workday, they had a 50% increased risk. If they did not switch to clean work clothes until the following day or later, they had an almost 5 times or 500% increased risk of non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. Use of organophosphate insecticides also appeared to increase the risk of non-Hodgkin's lymphoma in this study. Many of the farmers had both exposures, making it difficult to completely disentangle their effects. However, detailed analyses suggested that 2,4-D and organophosphates independently increase risk of non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. In neither study was duration, that is, years of use, related to risk. Average annual days of use appeared to be the strongest determinant of risk. Last week, NCI published a study in the Journal of the National Cancer Institute that reported a significantly higher risk for testicular seminomas and dysfunction in U.S. military working dogs that served in Vietnam rather than in military dogs who served in the continental U.S. It was hypothesized that exposures to phenoxyherbicides, dioxin, or tetracycline, an antibiotic used extensively in military working dogs in Vietnam, may be responsible. There are several other relevant epidemiologic studies that are underway at NCI. These include a study of approximately 30,000 pesticide applicators employed by a national lawn care service company, a study of approximately 2,000 Kansas County employees who apply herbicides to eradicate difficult-to-control weeds on public and private lands, and a case-control study of agricultural factors and leukemia and lymphoma, similar to the Kansas and Nebraska studies that's being conducted in Iowa and Minnesota, and a study of cancer among dogs in relation to their owners' use of pesticides used on lawns. Also in progress is a methodologic study to evaluate and improve exposure assessment in epidemiologic studies of agricultural exposure to pesticides. The laboratory animal studies on 2,4-D are equivocal. A recent two-year bioassay of 2,4-D in mice and rats resulted in a statistically significant increase in the incidence of brain tumors in male rats. However, since there was no similar increase in female rats, the 2,4-D industry task force which conducted the study has questioned whether a cause-effect relationship has been proven. EPA has requested that the study be repeated at higher dose levels. The mechanism for a possible carcinogenic effect of 2,4-D, which was the herbicide associated with the increased risk in our epidemiologic studies, is not known. 2,4-D does not appear to cause changes in the cell genetic material, DNA, like many carcinogens do. It's not thought generally to be contaminated with 2,3,7,8-TCDD, the dioxin congener that is carcinogenic and contaminates some other pesticide, phenoxyacetic acid herbicides. I am aware of one report from Germany that was issued a few years ago that challenges this assumption, and Admiral Zumwalt mentioned that we may hear more testimony this morning on that issue. It's been suggested that phenoxy herbicides may affect immune response, which is related to the development of non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. Phenoxy herbicides also affect certain enzyme systems, causing peroxisome proliferation, which is the mechanism for some non-genotoxic carcinogens, that is, carcinogens that do not act by altering cell DNA. Various laboratory studies are being considered at the National Cancer Institute and elsewhere to further investigate these questions. In summary, two NCI epidemiologic studies have shown an increased risk of non-Hodgkin's lymphoma among frequent users of agricultural herbicides. The herbicide which appeared to be responsible for the excess risks was 2,4-D, one of the herbicides in Agent Orange used in Vietnam. In our studies, the risks appeared to be limited to mixer applicators. This suggests that the reduction or elimination of dermal exposure can decrease risks to the level seen in non-users. The mechanism for the possible carcinogenic effect is not known, but is under laboratory investigation. And several related projects, including a national study of lawn care service applicators and other epidemiologic studies with detailed exposure data, are underway. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Horizon. Dr. Teitelbaum?
Good morning, Mr. Chairman. I'm Daniel T. I'm Daniel T. Teitelbaum, M.D. I'm a physician who practices medical toxicology in a private practice in Denver, Colorado. I'm associate clinical professor of preventive medicine at the University of Colorado Health Sciences Center and adjunct professor of environmental sciences at the Colorado School of Mines. Since my medical practice involves evaluation and treatment of people who believe they have been injured by a toxic material used in the course of their employment, or of persons who believe that they have been environmentally exposed to and injured by such materials, I've appeared as an expert witness in legal proceedings in which issues before the courts are the same as those as are before the committee at the present time. I also participated in the legal proceedings concerning Agent Orange. In that matter, I was a non-causation witness. My brief was to review the registration documents which had been submitted over the years by various manufacturers of 2,4-D and 2,4,5-T to the regulatory agencies which were responsible for registration of these materials for agricultural use. I reviewed these documents in order to understand the development of information on the toxicity of the herbicides. I have also seen various internal documents of manufacturers of these herbicides for common agricultural use. Some of these documents established that manufacturers of herbicides have been aware of the presence of contaminants other than TCDD or closely related dioxins or furans in their products for many years. In one instance, a manufacturer's internal files reflected the presence of 1,000 to 2,000 parts per million of tetrachloroxanthone, more specifically 1,3,6,8 tetrachloroxanthone, and octachlorobispirone in finished product 2,4-D. These novel contaminants appeared in the product as a consequence of a change in manufacturing technique. The still bottoms of this process were composed of up to 10% of these materials. No technique which was tried by the manufacturer was wholly successful in eliminating this potentially toxic material from the 2,4-D. I do not believe that the presence of these novel chlorinated contaminants in this manufacturer's 2,4-D has ever been reported to the EPA or the state registration agencies, nor am I able to establish that these contaminants have been studied for acute or chronic toxicity, carcinogenicity, teratogenicity, or any other property by the manufacturer, the EPA, the state regulatory agencies, the National Toxicology Program, or anyone else. that are likely still in the 2,4-D, which is in use in today's American agriculture. For this and other reasons, the toxicity of 2,4-D currently available remains uncertain. My review of the documents which were discovered in the Agent Orange lawsuit, which are available in the Agent Orange case files at the United States District Court for the Eastern District of New York and Brooklyn, confirmed for me in the 1980s what I had learned from examination and treatment of herbicide-exposed patients and from the open scientific literature over the preceding years. Although the manufacturers reported findings to each other, they did not enter information into the open scientific literature. From the outset of my practice, the problems reported to me by workers who applied, formulated, or manufactured 2,4-D or 2,4-5-T were malaise and weakness, skin irritation, tingling and other sensory disturbances, thought disorder, loss of libido, and personality changes. Objective investigation of these workers confirmed that the complaints were organically based. Examination of the skin showed acute irritation and occasionally the residual findings of chloracne. Examination of the nervous system demonstrated sensory or mixed sensory motor peripheral neuropathy. Neuropsychological evaluation demonstrated personality changes and cognitive disorder. Liver function tests indicated hepatocellular damage, and porphyrin studies revealed porphyrinuria, which implied a disturbance in red cell assembly. Organic neurological disorders, both of central and peripheral nature, liver abnormalities, and porphyrinuria continue to be found in 2,4-5-T and 2,4-D manufacturing workers. In the most recent group of workers whom I have evaluated, these very disorders, some of which were detected years ago in a broad-based review of the health status of herbicide manufacturing workers, have been found again. Years after the termination of their work in the industry and years after they were first evaluated, the abnormalities persist in some of the patients. This is not at all surprising, since in some of the workers whose tissue dioxin levels were measured recently, very high levels of TCDD persist. Although I have seen fewer workers with malignant disease which seem related to exposure to herbicides than workers with dose-related toxic diseases due to herbicides, I'm personally convinced that the scientific literature on this subject supports the position that 2,4-D and 2,4-5-T are carcinogenic to humans and that they cause lymphomas and soft tissue sarcomas in agriculturally exposed workers. I'm not at all convinced that the entire explanation of the apparent carcinogenic effect of herbicides is based upon the TCDD content in 2,4-5-T. In the agricultural setting, most exposures to herbicides are compound. They involve both 2,4-5-T and 2,4-D, as well as other herbicides. It appears to me that there are other contaminants in herbicides, as well as herbicides per se, which have not been adequately evaluated for carcinogenicity in animals, let alone studied for their effect or accumulation in humans by any person or agency. Most recently, I've begun an investigation of a group of workers who have been exposed to chlorophenols, including pentachlorophenol, which was used in the papermaking industry. In the first small group who have been examined, a lymphoma and a hairy cell leukemia have been found. Both of these tumors are the type which have been observed in excess in forestry and agricultural workers exposed to herbicides. Although animal toxicologists had studied the basic toxicology of herbicides 2,4-D and 2,4-5-T from the 1940s onward, the literature had merely hinted at the target organ toxicity which physicians might expect to see. Manufacturers of herbicides in Germany and in the United States already knew that precisely the diseases which I and others were struggling to diagnose in workers had occurred in their employees long before the reports began to appear in the open scientific literature in the mid-1970s. These diseases had developed following accidents in manufacturing, which led to plant contamination and worker absorption of unusual quantities of chloracnogenic materials in the manufacture of 2,4-5-T and its precursors, and in the routine course of manufacture of herbicides, even when no unusual exposures had taken place. Manufacturing and medical personnel of chemical companies in the United States and in Germany reported to each other their adverse experiences with these materials. They described the illnesses which developed in their workers in the 1950s and 60s and the manufacturing processes which produced the illnesses. These reports were rendered in confidential correspondence between process licensees. They were also discussed at reciprocal plant visits and at meetings of special committees of the National Agricultural Chemical Association, as reflected in the Agent Orange discovery documents. In the exchange of information among herbicide manufacturers, medical examination of workers who had occupational diseases due to the herbicide manufacturing process were presented. These reports fully described the causes and nature of the dose-related diseases which occurred. The physicians, toxicologists, basic scientists, and managers of these corporations did not report the observed and documented toxicity to humans of their products to the regulatory agencies, the Department of Defense, the Department of Agriculture, the general public, or the scientific community. Only after Secretary of Defense Melvin Laird moved to terminate the use of Agent Orange in Vietnam because of suspected reproductive toxicity did the toxicity information on herbicides and dioxin, which was in the hands of the manufacturers, become known. The Agent Orange discovery documents reveal that in the month in which 124D245T manufacturing company was informing Secretary Laird of the reproductive toxicity of the material in Agent Orange, another manufacturer was writing to Secretary of Agriculture Clifford Hardin to protest the cancellation of its registrations for 245T for certain domestic uses in the United States on grounds that the reproductive toxicity to humans was not proved. As I look back at my experience in the evaluation of patients who have been exposed to herbicides and the illnesses which they develop, and compare it to the information which was available to the manufacturers but not to the medical community or the general public for many years, I feel a sense of frustration. Clearly, this is a subject over which there has been an extraordinary amount of controversy, and the controversy will not soon be set aside. Its resolution will require large-scale, expensive scientific studies. Whether these studies will ever be undertaken or completed, I do not know. The history of the development of information on the toxicity of herbicides is a sorry tale. Review of the way the information developed and the misery which resulted from this misdirection may prevent similar problems in the future.
Thank you, Dr. Teitelbaum. Dr. Kahn, pull the microphone in front of you first.
Oh, right. When I teach, I don't bother with microphones. My voice carries. Thank you for the opportunity to testify. In doing so, I wish to make it clear that I'm here as an individual. Although a professor at Rutgers University and a member of the New Jersey State Commission on Agent Orange, I speak today for neither. There was not enough time for the commission in particular to discuss these remarks in order to endorse them. Several people have been helpful to me in preparing this testimony. I've drawn on the ideas of Therese Gent-Gunther, William Lewis, Dr. Stephen and Jean Stellman, and Dr. Ralph Fogelman. I thank them for their help, although they are not responsible for what I have to say. My written remarks discuss examples of federal research. Most studies show no statistically significant correlation with service in Vietnam. In most cases, subgroups of veterans appear to be at increased risks, however, with some of these risks being quite large. There is often also a trend in the risk in that the greater the opportunity for exposure, the greater the risk. Such trends are called dose-response relationships. They're important, for they support the connection between exposure and later medical consequences. Neither the subgroup risks nor the trends reach statistical significance, however. The number of cases is invariably too small. Even so, the CDC's birth defect study did have some significant correlations of defects with Vietnam service. From the data in hand at the time, however, the CDC could not distinguish a real finding from a fluke, although a dose-response relationship did suggest that the results were real. Standard practice is to follow a broad screening such as the CDC's with a tightly focused study on each item which showed an association. Instead, the CDC simply declared the result to be a fluke and declined to follow it up. Although the studies were presented as negative in the wide publicity put out by the government, neither the VA study of soft tissue sarcoma nor the CDC's of birth defects, for example, was in fact negative. There is a difference between a positive study which does not achieve statistical significance and a negative study. The fundamental flaw in these studies, as in much federal work, is their use of Vietnam service as the principal indicator of herbicide exposure. It is no such thing. It is an enormous misclassification error, for the majority of men who served there were not significantly exposed. This introduces a bias into the work. It dilutes the findings, making strong associations weaker and causing less strong ones to disappear altogether. Because misclassification reduces the apparent differences between exposed and unexposed groups, moreover, it causes risks to be underestimated. Unless other compensating errors overestimate the risks, the epidemiological reality may be worse than it appears. Federal epidemiologists, some accepted, are among the best in the world, some not accepted. They are certainly aware of the perils of misclassification bias. Yet they persist in using Vietnam service as the principal measure of exposure. They do look at other measures, and more often than not, these, as crude as they are, show a dose-response relationship. This is largely ignored or downplayed. It certainly is never brought out in presentations to the press or Congress. Why? We come now to the public presentation of federal research. The selected cancer study is a good example. There was a press conference, there was a press release, and a short executive summary, pre-digested for maximum media impact. I'm not aware of any presentation in a forum in which critical evaluation of the results by professional peers was possible, which would have allowed the press to obtain a balanced view. Had we in New Jersey done what the CDC did with the selected cancer study, the Federals would have cut us to ribbons for doing science by press release. Why should they be exempt from the strictures which apply to everyone else? And yet everything they produce is presented with immense fanfare. Detailed scrutiny by outside professionals may not happen for weeks or months and generates little press coverage. I'd wager the people who orchestrate the public presentation of federal research know that. It makes one wonder whom they're trying to impress, not their scientific peers. Could it be Congress, the press, and the public? If so, we're dealing more with politics than with science. Before leaving the subject of federal research, I'd like to consider the Agent Orange Working Group's influence on the federal effort. It appears the working group caused the Air Force to bury its study of birth defects in the children of ranch hand men for the last 6 years. It's possible that errors in the study invalidate the result and the government doesn't want to confuse matters by publishing it. Somehow, I doubt that. But even so, it would be better to bring the study forth for public review, following which it could be done again if needed. Apparently, the government is deliberately concealing a finding of considerable importance both scientifically and to the veterans. Although not outright fraud in the sense of publication of falsified results, it comes close in that it perpetuates the government's claim of no connection between exposure and later medical problems in the face of evidence to the contrary. With respect to the ranch hand morbidity study, having now read both the Air Force's first draft of the report's final summary chapter and the version ultimately released, I am angry. The draft contained a data table summarizing the nearly 200 items measured on the ranch handers and the control veterans. Most were the same in the two groups. Of those which differed, however, the ranch handers suffered health deficits 3 to 5 times more frequently than did the controls. As a result of the working group's review, this table was not in the final version. There were, as well, many other changes in the final version, all having the effect of converting a non-negative study into a reassuring one. This is even more troubling than the suppression of the birth defect study, for it involves a deliberate alteration of research results, the omission of data, and the rewriting of conclusions for political ends. If there is anything which can discredit science and scientists in the eyes of the general public, this is it. Do we really want to do that? Political manipulation of research in the service of policy has so tainted the federal government's work on Agent Orange that it has largely lost its legitimacy. At every turn, the errors, omissions, changes, and general tone of discussion fit a pattern. They minimize the connection between exposure and later medical problems. What of the current state of the science? Much of what I have to say was said by the American Legion Task Force on which I serve in its recent report. Here, I'd like to make one other point. It concerns the kind of links we will accept between exposure and disease. Our present approach is piecemeal. We debate whether or not to compensate for this condition or that. The process is ponderous, and the conditions for which compensation is granted are limited to a very few veterans. The mountain labors and produces a mouse. Given what is now in the research literature, we could write down what one might call the dioxin syndrome. It would be a set of problems which encompass the biological consequences of exposure. No one person would be expected to suffer from all the problems in the set, for people vary considerably in their susceptibility to chemical toxins, as they do in most respects. The presence of some, such as NHL or soft tissue sarcoma and others, might individually qualify a person for aid. In addition, however, a veteran displaying some reasonable subset of the syndrome should qualify. Where do we go from here with respect to research? We've clearly wasted 10 years, and the longer we wait, the harder it becomes to do rigorous work. Nevertheless, in my written testimony, I offer some specific proposals. I'll describe them later, if you wish. For over a decade now, the policy has been that until science can convict dioxin beyond reasonable doubt in the sense of a murder conviction, we will do as little for the veteran as possible, and that little is done grudgingly. It may be decades before the sort of overwhelming evidence the government seems to demand emerges. Consider the history of research on cigarette smoking. dioxin is a much harder problem, for reasons I can discuss during questioning, if you wish. Science and scientists are thus thrust out in front and made to seem the obstacle to a change in policy. Gee, fellas, we'd love to help you, but the science isn't there, so we can't. This puts us in an impossible position. Doing research takes an immense amount of time and care. It cannot be rushed, and it must follow its own inner logic or it will go nowhere. It is not like producing McDonald's hamburgers. Nevertheless, people grow impatient. Some become bitter and angry. Others lose heart and decide to drop the issue and get on with their lives as well as they can. In effect, what the government has done is to hide behind a facade of scientific objectivity. But because science and scientists are seen as the stumbling block, science is discredited in the public mind, and scientists and veterans are set at loggerheads. Again, as a nation, do we really want to do that? It would be much better simply to take care of those veterans who have problems for which there are plausible grounds to suspect a connection with military service, even if ironclad proof may be lacking. This would take the pressure off science and allow us to proceed in an orderly way, free of hysteria, to learn what dioxin and the herbicides do and don't cause. The underlying issue is not primarily scientific. It is political and moral. What do we as a country owe those we sent off to war, particularly to an unpopular war? For a variety of reasons, we have treated the Vietnam veterans shabbily. And if we treat shabbily those who served the country in the past, who will serve it in the future, militarily or otherwise? I have spent my entire adult life doing research and teaching science. Whatever the human failings of the individuals who take part in it, I teach that the enterprise is a noble one. The spectacle of the U.S. government concealing a failure of political will and moral courage behind a demand for research is appalling. It demeans the veterans, the general public, science, and the government itself. As a people, we can ill afford it.
Thank you, Dr. Kahn. Dr. Teitelbaum, you testified that manufacturers of herbicides have covered up the presence of certain toxic chlorinated contaminants in their products for many years. You said that these contaminants have not been reported to EPA or state registration agency. Do you know why?
I suspect because the manufacturers just didn't wish to do so. So far as I can tell from the documents, they were reported widely within the companies to all of the various levels, including people who should have reported them but did not.
You say that these contaminants are contained in 2,4-D. Is 2,4-D an ingredient in herbicides currently used today in the United States?
Oh, yes, very widely.
How prevalent?
You can go into any hardware store or feed store and buy it and use it on your lawn. It's used very widely in agriculture. It's one of the most widely available herbicides in the country.
The contaminants to which you refer are xanthan 9-1s. You testified that these are toxic in animal studies and may be chlorinogenic and mutagenic. Specifically, what kinds of problems could these contaminants cause?
Well, the compound is structurally related to the dioxins and furans. It is so structured that it's reasonable to think that the receptors that would handle dioxins would also have problems with this compound, and therefore it would be highly suspect as a carcinogen both in animals and in humans. Given the epidemiologic evidence as well that 2,4-D is a human carcinogen, and that 2,4-D per se, clean 2,4-D, if it ever was clean, is not apparently mutagenic in animal studies, this particular compound becomes one of great interest and demands an adequate study.
The people exposed to these contaminants, your judgment, are at risk of ill health effects, are they?
Yes, they are.
You also testified that manufacturers, including their own medical personnel, in Germany and the United States, share information about illnesses caused by their products, but withhold the information from regulators and the public. To this day, have federal regulatory agencies been apprised of the information withheld by the manufacturers?
I don't think so. It is in the Agent Orange documents, and there's the peculiar problem that the courts put protective orders on this kind of material. The EPA does not have access to the OSHA records within the companies, and so you have this division between what's looked at within the plant by OSHA and what's looked at outside the plant by the EPA, and for whatever reason, the cross-communication never takes place.
Which manufacturers were engaged in the cover-up that you described?
In this particular case, the manufacturer was Dow, and in addition, Diamond Shamrock and Monsanto were involved.
When did these exchanges of information take place?
In the 60s, long before the study by Litton Bionetics, long before any of the work on chloracne had been published in the open literature. The original manufacturer was Boehringer Ingelheim in Germany. They reported to Dow, who were apparently licensed to produce herbicide using their product. Dow had the same problem in their plants. They reported it to the National Agricultural Chemical Association in a series of task force meetings. Nobody bothered to tell either the Department of Defense, which was buying the product, the various distributors, or anyone else.
Which toxic effects did the manufacturers know about but not report?
Well, as I indicated in the written testimony, they knew about neuropsychological effects, they knew about chloracne, they knew about liver disorders, they knew about hepatic porphyria, and they knew about changes in libido and sexual performance. All of these were described. They were studied very carefully by the medical departments. There's an extensive record in the Agent Orange documents of those reports.
You testified that TCDD in combination with other contaminants may be a promoter or cause of disease. In light of your testimony, I gather you do not believe that testing Vietnam veterans solely for dioxin would be an effective way of determining risk of disease.
I believe that it's appropriate to do what Dr. Schechter indicated earlier, which is to look not only for TCDD, but for all of the closely related compounds. The approach analytically would permit that. And once you take the sample, it would be just terrible waste not to do a broad-based analytical study.
And let me ask you the same question that I asked Admiral Zumbold. Do you believe that United States citizens are adequately protected from the hazards of herbicide exposure?
I do not.
Thank you. Dr. Horzam, you testified that a study to be published in September found that farmers who used herbicides containing 2,4-D were at greater risk of non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. How prevalent is the use of 2,4-D in the United States?
Oh, it's very prevalent. It's one of the most commonly used agricultural herbicides, especially throughout the Midwest where there's a lot of wheat and corn growing. It's also used by lawn care service companies and homeowners to control weeds in their lawns in urban and suburban settings.
I'm having difficulty hearing you.
It's one of the most commonly used agricultural herbicides. It's used on wheat, corn, rice, sorghum. It's also used on pasture land. It's used to control weeds on rights of ways, and also it's used by homeowners and lawn care service companies to control weeds on lawns.
We heard testimony from Dr. Teitelbaum of his concerns about unknown toxic contaminants in 2,4-D. Were you aware of these contaminants?
Yes, I think it's well established in the literature that 2,4-D has many dioxin isomers present in it. Some of those have not been adequately evaluated in toxicological studies. I think the debate that has come in has been whether TCDD, a particular dioxin congener, which is considered carcinogenic, is present in 2,4-D. It was generally accepted for many years that it was not present. However, I've seen at least one report from Germany and heard about other reports which have found it. And I think they're primarily due to contamination in the manufacturing process. The same packaging equipment is used to make 2,4-5-T, which does have TCD in it, as is used to package 2,4-D. Situations like that arise, so that it has been documented that 2,4-D can have TCD in it, again, as well as other dioxin isomers, which haven't been evaluated very adequately.
Is it possible that these contaminants may be responsible for the elevated incidence of cancer that you found?
It's possible. Our studies can't determine exactly what it is about the 2,4-D that's elevating the risk of non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. They have to be evaluated in conjunction with toxicological data.
Federal studies of Agent Orange have focused on 2,4-5. Centers for Disease Control found significant elevations of non-Hodgkin's lymphoma in Vietnam veterans. Is it possible that 2,4-D is the cause of illness among Vietnam veterans, not only 2,4-5-T, as previously believed?
I think it's possible.
It is illegal in this country to market known carcinogens. In light of your research, do you believe 2,4-D should be more tightly regulated?
Yes, I definitely think more information should be given to the public about use of protective equipment and how to protect oneself if one has to use it. For example, I think that a case could be made for continuing to use it in some agricultural settings. And with protection, our studies show that risk could be lowered to that of non-users. I'm not sure a case could be made for continuing to use it on lawns.
The National Cancer Institute reported recently that the incidence of non-Hodgkin's lymphoma increased faster than any other cancer between 1973 and 1987. Does this increase have anything to do with herbicide used here and in Vietnam?
Yeah, there has been a documented increase. The incidence has increased 50% over the time frame that you've mentioned, and it's one of the top three as far as increases. The only thing faster, I think, is lung cancer in women and breast cancer. The causes are hard to determine. Some are related to AIDS-associated lymphomas, but that accounts for a very small percentage. The use of herbicides in the U.S. may account for a percentage of the increase. It's probably a small percentage, however, because of the percent of the population which is heavily exposed is small outside of kind of the agricultural states. So we're not sure right now. It's one of the big questions that NCI and other groups, I'm sure, are considering is what is related. We intend to have a workshop, actually, where experts will come in and try to evaluate the different postulated causes and whether they can account for the entire increase that's been observed.
Thank you very much. Before I yield to Mr. Army, let me take note of the fact that we've been joined by another of our distinguished subcommittee members, Ileana Ross Lefton in Florida. Thank you very much for your participation. Do you have any opening comments you'd like to make? No. Mr. Army?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to thank you all for your scientific testimony. I appreciate that you're all well trained in your disciplines, and I appreciate the importance of having good disciplined research. Now, having said that, I'd like to see if I could get you to help me understand a little bit beyond what's probably your area of expertise, but perhaps is an area in which you've had more ability to experience and observe. I'm particularly interested in the extent to which, maybe if I could address this to Dr. Horizon, because you've been involved in the Kansas study, apparently, and Nebraska study. Would you say that the use of this herbicide or herbicides is on the increase in our agricultural states in recent years? Have we seen a marked or a dramatic increase in the use?
There had been a dramatic increase. 2,4-D was introduced in the late 1940s. I think it was developed in 47 and kind of was begun to be used 1949 or so. And throughout, say, the late 1950s and the 60s, the use increased dramatically. At this point in time, over the last three or four years, since some of these results have become known, I'm not sure if there's been some tapering off or not. I'd have to do some research and maybe submit it for the record. But a large, large volume of these herbicides are used every year.
I assume that the individual farmer uses this to get a greater yield on his acreage.
Right, to reduce the competing weeds that would be in the fields.
The competing what?
Weeds.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I'm just curious if you don't suppose that the policies of the federal government to take 61 million acres of agricultural land out of production might have provided some incentive for these farmers to resort to this kind of a practice as opposed to in pursuit of the subsidize agricultural price for their output and a guarantee that they're going to get that higher than market price. Let me just say that you all have been, most of you have been very willing in this testimony to step outside your area of scientific expertise and make suggestions about the lack of responsibility on the part of business, the military, or even members of Congress and the executive branch. And it would seem to me that this area of economic policy in the United States deserves a good deal of focus of your attention and along those lines. I am very much concerned, having grown up in an agricultural community and having been warned repeatedly by my own father about some of these chemicals and so forth that we naturally came in touch with, that it is our own policies in agriculture that not only provides an incentive, but in fact, perhaps, as perceived by the farmer himself, an imperative to use more and more of these chemical substances. I was just curious if any of you would have any observations along those lines. From what you've experienced out
Congressman,
there.
Congressman, I don't think it would explain the use on lawns. The dandelions are a big problem in Colorado, but 2,4-D is the preferred dandelion killer, and I think that the observations regarding agriculture will not deal with children running barefoot on 2,4-D treated lawns. That worries me a great deal, too.
Well, my parting observation is folks in Colorado should have known my father. He understood a teenage son with a long knife and very strong, weak, strong knees was the worst menace to dandelions.
There you go.
It's called the AstroTurf mentality.
I think we have, though, the dioxins being found from various industrial sources, not only the herbicides from wood preservatives, the chlorinated phenols from paper and pulp bleaching, from industrial incineration, from municipal incinerators. These are getting into the food supply and meat, milk, fish products. And in fact, we're seeing in Holland today where cattle from near municipal incinerators are not permitted in some cases because of dioxins to be used for milk or meat. So I think the dioxin issue is started with Agent Orange in our minds, but it's gone far beyond that in our society. And we do have evidence that it's highly toxic.
I have some more questions, but we've been cautioned that the chamber is rapidly getting filled and that we really ought to go over there. Dr. Kahn and Dr. Schechter, could you come back after the break?
Yes.
Say yes. And
certainly.
Dr. Tardemann, Dr. Zuck. If you can come also. Thank you. The subcommittee now stands recessed, and we will return with 50 minutes after the joint session concludes. The subcommittee is now back in session, and if our panelists will take their seats. Thank you for bearing with us today. Dr. Kahn, you were asked to review a draft copy of the Air Force Ranch Hand Birth Defect Study, which found ranch hand personnel to be at greater risk of fathering offspring with birth defects after service in Vietnam. The Centers for Disease Control also studied birth defects among Vietnam veterans. How do the Air Force findings compare to the CDC findings?
Well, they're looking at two different groups of people. In both cases, you have positive findings. In the case of the CDC study published some years ago, using the Atlanta Region Registry of Birth Defects, they looked at a very large number of defects. I believe it was close to 100 as possible outcomes. And they found three that showed a correlation with service in Vietnam. And these were cleft palate and cleft lip taken together, spina bifida, and a catch-all category called other neoplasms. These did definitely correlate with Vietnam service, and it was statistically significant, and it even showed a dose-response relationship of a sort, a crude one. Unfortunately, in a study of that kind, which is a broad screening, you cast a very broad net, you look at a whole lot of outcomes, you have no way of knowing whether scattered positive findings of the sort they got are real, meaning reflect the underlying biology, or whether they are a statistical artifact. And such artifacts do happen. From the data available at the time, you couldn't tell the difference, although the fact that you did have a dose response suggests that it might have been real. Standard practice, I'm told by my epidemiologist friends, is that you then go and you do a tightly focused study on each thing that you find, maybe using a database in another part of the country or another time period or something of the sort, to find out if what might be real is real. Instead of doing that, and in fact the CDC promised that they would do that if they found anything in the defect study, instead of doing so, they dismissed the positive findings as statistical flukes, right, and declined to follow them up. And there the subject remains. It has not been followed up. Now, in the case of the Ranch Hand report, the draft report that was sent to me a few days ago, I have read it over. And the principal finding here is very, very interesting. They did a clever thing. They had enough births that they could compare the babies that were conceived before the man served in Southeast Asia with those who were conceived afterwards, right, since many of these men were married before they went overseas. Now, it is true that as a man ages, the likelihood that he will father a child with a defect goes up. Right? The same thing is true for as women age. They're more likely to bear children with defects. And among their unexposed veterans, their controls, the people whom they call their comparisons, they did see that rise with age. Okay? If they hadn't seen that, you'd wonder that something might be wrong. What they saw in the exposed men, the ranch handers, was that that rise with age was much steeper than for the controls. And the difference in the rises with age was statistically significant. That's the main finding that's here. And I don't think any amount of data checking and changing and what have you, or obtaining of more data, is going to reduce that finding. It might remain the same and it might get stronger. Moreover, the fact that ranch hand service per se is not a terribly good index of exposure means that there is some dilution built into this. So that if you were to obtain a perfect index of exposure, not that that's possible, this finding would probably become stronger.
I think you may have answered this, but for the record, did the CDC study show a dose-response relationship involving Agent Orange exposure among veterans whose offspring had birth defects?
It showed a dose response for what they called the exposure opportunity index, okay, which was an index that they had the environmental support group at the Defense Department calculate for them, or they used support group methods to calculate it. I can't remember which. Right, now, that's a very crude measure of exposure, and the fact that it showed that indicates that the reality was probably worse than published.
CDC tested the blood of Vietnam veterans to identify dioxin. CDC is also testing the blood of the victims of an industrial accident involving dioxin exposure. What has CDC found in Seveso, and is it relevant to Agent Orange research?
Well, there was recently presented by the CDC blood tests on serum samples that were supposedly taken soon after the accident there in 1976. I'm not exactly sure how soon, but certainly within a few months from what they published. The levels in those samples were extremely high, up to as high as, I believe, 27,000 parts per trillion, if I remember exactly.
50,000.
There was a 50,000 in there? Oh, well. The claim was made that the people who had these very high levels are not sick, and therefore, if those people are not sick, nobody else could possibly be sick. That's the argument that has been made from those data. I'm not sure that argument is logical in and of itself unless you really look hard at a lot of people to make sure you know what you've got. I don't think we know what we've got in the Seveso case. But there's another problem that has me concerned about that. My colleague, Christopher Rappe, in whose laboratory the New Jersey specimens are analyzed, was asked by the Italian government, to go to Italy in the aftermath of the accident. He recommended, when he went there, that they archive samples of mother's milk and of human serum against the time when it would become possible to analyze them. The milk had already been analyzed by Nesselson and Bachmann, but it wasn't something that any laboratory was doing regularly at that time. In 1984, he was invited to go back as part of an all-European commission of inquiry convened by the Italian government to evaluate Italian research of the time. And he asked the Italians, "Did you archive blood or milk?" And he was told, "No, we didn't archive any samples at all." This is troubling, because if in 84 they hadn't archived any samples at all, where did the samples come from that the CDC analyzed in 1988 or 89? Now, there may have been a mix-up in communications, but I would like somebody to answer that question for me.
Mr. Chairman, may I also make a comment about the Seveso and
Please.
The wrench end? We also think that there are lessons to be drawn by measurement of tissue dioxin. One of the lessons from Seveso, looking at the CDC data, is that the indirect measures of exposure, such as are used by the Air Force in the Air Force Health Study published February 1990, or the CDC selected cancer studies where only indirect measurements were taken, does not, including chloracne, does not necessarily reflect the amount of dioxin that gets into people. In Seveso, some people with very high levels had no chloracne. In the ranch hand studies, when we looked at ranch handers with the Massachusetts study, we found approximately a tenfold difference on a very small sample in the amount of dioxin that really could be measured, that we could measure using a number of different laboratories, three different laboratories. So the potential for exposure is different than the real exposure, and these indirect measures that are frequently used are not very helpful. And people also are different. We're not like laboratory animals. We're genetically different. Some of us are more sensitive, some of us less sensitive. Like with cigarettes, 8 out of 10 lung cancers in this country, as we teach our medical school students, are caused by cigarettes. But most people who smoke cigarettes won't get lung cancer. It's just that the risk is increased in the population, and the risk of well-characterized illnesses, cancer, immune deficiency, liver damage, nerve damage, reproductive toxicity, has been well characterized in laboratory animals, wildlife, and a number of studies, particularly from Asia, the rice oil poisoning and elsewhere.
Dr. Kahn, you had, while you were giving us your prepared testimony, said that you would save recommendations for future conduct of Agent Orange studies for this period. Would you now give us your thoughts on that?
Have you got a copy of my written testimony? I don't.
Yeah, I'm sure we do.
They've evaporated. Nobody has a copy?
Here.
I'll return it.
Yes, thank you.
I've thought fairly hard about this. What we in Jersey do is correctly characterized as a series of small probing pilot studies designed to gain lessons, if they're of the lessons learned type of thing, which could be used as background in designing something on a larger scale or in deciding what other direction to go in or what is a dead end. And we've hit a few of those. And so I've thought hard about where we ought to go. And one of the So I have a series of recommendations here, and so here they go, okay? The first is I would disband the Agent Orange Working Group, okay? Get rid of it. It's destructive, to put it mildly. The second is I would launch an inquiry into the Air Force's ranch hand study with the aim of seeing if it can be salvaged. If it can, put it under some kind of outside supervision, and by which that I mean supervision by an unbiased entity not under governmental control. And that supervision must have teeth in it. I don't care how you make the teeth. You can figure that out. That's your kind of work. Develop some means of protecting government scientists from retribution
so there, should their conclusions not agree with those of the political structure. And the third recommendation is clean house at the CDC. Most people don't understand that the centers for disease control are plural, centers, not center. Even though they're more or less independent entities, we risk having all of them compromised in the public mind, and the visible house cleaning would prevent that. The centers have a deservedly high reputation, and that ought to be protected. We can't afford to risk losing public confidence in them as a whole. If we'd had our collective wits about us at the beginning of this process 10 years ago, we should have funded a large number of small investigator-initiated pilot projects, each for perhaps 1 to 5 years. I say investigator-initiated, for one of the lessons a research career has taught me is that the only people who will doggedly find ways around the inevitable obstacles that arise in any research project are those who want to know the answer, whatever it may be, so badly they can taste it. The person who initiates an idea has that vested interest in solving the problems. The alternative to investigator-initiated is the sort of top-down research, right, in which very senior people dictate the nature of what is to be done, while those who actually do the work have very limited input or control over what happens. This has been one of the flaws in the federal effort. Every other year, since it takes more than a year to get much in the way of research results, we should convene special sessions at one or two of the scientific society meetings to take stock of where we are. And by running these through the professional societies, we'll reduce the cost to the government, we'll place the work in a proper scientific atmosphere, and we would also be doing the evaluation of the research and of future directions in research in public, where anybody can have an input. These sessions could also be used to air proposals for major projects. And should it become clear that a large-scale health study is desirable, then this is the forum in which that clarity will emerge. Congressional committees, the GAO, and the Veterans Organization should all monitor these meetings to remain informed of the current state of the art and to use the information in continued funding decisions. One or two meetings of this sort could be very helpful initially in identifying research areas needing attention, and there are some, quite a few. The project should be selected by competitive peer review of proposals in the way the NIH and the NSF evaluate proposals. Funds could be distributed to the various institutes of the NIH and programs of the NSF as appropriate to the content of whatever is deemed worthy of support. Some sort of loose coordination would be needed to ensure the scientific areas needing work are in fact covered. A loose coordination could be supplied by an ad hoc advisory group, perhaps under the auspices of the National Academy of Sciences. The membership of such a group would have to be carefully selected to ensure that the fox does not end up watching the hen house. Most of the projects should be done by people not affiliated with the government. The VA does have some good people in its research system, though, and they should certainly not be precluded from competing for support on an equal basis. Talk to Vietnam veterans. The federal government has consistently assumed that they have nothing useful to say, that whatever they do have to say is a self-serving trick to extract money from the government. Although there are some such people, that is not generally true. We in New Jersey have gained a great deal of practical insight into conditions on the ground from countless conversations with the men and women who served. They are experts in a sense. They were there. The scientist is perfectly able to sort out what is scientifically useful from what is not, but only after hearing what the veterans have to say and after asking lots and lots of questions. Therefore, some arrangement for researchers to learn what the vets have to tell us should be devised. My fifth recommendation is that the CDC's dioxin lab should continue to be supported at its present level or higher. It is a good lab whose services should be made available to investigators with projects funded under this proposal and to other investigators as well. It might be a good idea to rethink its relationship to the CDC. The sixth is increased support for the Joint Services Environmental Support Group. It is being allowed to wither. They're down to approximately 10 people and have lost their Marine Corps liaison, which makes their work much harder. For a variety of reasons, the Marines are excellent candidates for study. The work of the ESG is highly specialized. Once lost, it will be very hard to recreate it, and we are losing it. Whatever research is done in the future, you can bet the help of the ESG is needed.
My seventh recommendation, I actually discussed at some length in my oral testimony, and that is get the pressure off science. Get us out from in front. Let us go back into the quiet of the laboratory and do the work free of the glare of publicity and free of hysteria. Otherwise, you're not going to get people to pick up this work. I have trouble getting colleagues interested in dioxin-related research because it's too controversial. Most scientists are timid about getting into areas in which any controversy is possible. And so the recommendations I made earlier about taking care of the veterans in order to get the pressure off our backs, I would like to reinforce.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it. Dr. Schachter, I'd like to ask you some questions. You're one of the few U.S. scientists who've actually investigated the effects of Agent Orange in Vietnam. Is that correct?
Yes, I've worked in Vietnam since 1984.
And strictly from an epidemiological standpoint, how would you describe the research material and subjects available for studying the effects of Agent Orange in Vietnam?
I would regard it as a unique opportunity to learn in a more rapid fashion what the human health consequences are of the phenoxyherbicides and dioxin, for the reason that Agent Orange was applied in Vietnam. The Vietnamese people had the heaviest exposure for the longest period of time, and there are large numbers of them in the south exposed to Agent Orange and dioxin, the dioxin of Agent Orange and also other dioxins from industry. When we look at the north and measure dioxins in blood, milk, fat, other organs of the body in Vietnam from the hospitals, the medical schools, the health ministry, helping us to find the patients, we find extremely low levels of dioxins in the people in the north of Vietnam. In contrast, like people in the United States, we find much higher levels of dioxin in the southern, the south of Vietnam people, particularly the dioxin of Agent Orange. The highest level of dioxin from Agent Orange to date was recorded in a Vietnamese woman when John Constable and Matthew Messelson brought back her milk from Tan Nguyen Village in the south of Vietnam. And this was analyzed and found to be 1,400 parts per trillion of TCDD. So the dioxin from Agent Orange does get into people. We find it easily in the people in the south of Vietnam. We still can find it in some American veterans, although I agree with Dr. Khan that the percent of American veterans who served in Vietnam, one should not make the assumption that because you went to Vietnam, because a veteran went to Vietnam, he or she is necessarily at risk or had increased Agent Orange body burden. When we measure people in Vietnam, some have much higher levels of dioxin, some have much lower levels. When we measure American Vietnam veterans, including the Ranch Hand series we did in Massachusetts, some had much higher levels of the dioxin from Agent Orange, and some had less, much lower levels.
What would be the benefits to Vietnam veterans of having the United States government do a study of Agent Orange exposure in cooperation with the government of Vietnam?
I would again follow up my very articulate colleague, Dr. Khan, and urge that the mechanism be funding through medical schools, universities, and schools of public health. And I think what we'll learn is, number one, where are the levels of dioxin elevated in Vietnam, and how do these correspond to where American Vietnam veterans served? Was the dioxin, was the Agent Orange moved to a different location by the rains, and perhaps intake was higher, not where the spraying occurred, but elsewhere? So we need to map out blood levels or human tissue levels in Vietnam for our own veterans' sake and compare it with American veterans at the same time. This is the only sensitive and specific measure we have now for Agent Orange intake into the body. The other thing is that the health studies, the Vietnamese who are studying Agent Orange believe that they're finding increase in cancers, several types of cancers, which is what you would expect from a promoter of cancer rather than an initiator. It's not like It's not like asbestos where we have a signal lesion, perhaps. With a mesothelioma, if I have a patient with a mesothelioma in the abdomen or chest, I think of asbestos. But we don't have necessarily, although we may have the soft tissue sarcoma, the non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, if you have a promoter, you may be having many types of cancer increased. Vietnamese health research suggests that maybe the increase in cancers may be related, liver cancers and other types, to Agent Orange Spring. In addition, there are reproductive studies suggesting, as one would expect from animal studies, that there may well be an increase in congenital malformations, spontaneous abortions, and maybe in utero fetal death in those villages with heavier spraying of Agent Orange as compared with villages which seem similar except for the Agent Orange. We need to use the best American techniques, whether it's working with the Dioxin Laboratory at the Centers for Disease Control, which is an excellent laboratory, and using the best health techniques, the best epidemiologic techniques we have, and work in Vietnam.
Would the government of Vietnam, Dr. Khan, you have something to add?
Please. Also, as to what we could do for Vietnam veterans in Vietnam, I mean American Vietnam veterans right. in Vietnam, which was your question, Vietnam is a natural laboratory of a kind that we can't duplicate in this country. We can do some things there that you can't do very easily here. One of the things you do in any kind of a research project is you want to have controls. You want people of no exposure, if you can find that. And in America, you can't, because there are no people in America whose body burdens of dioxin are effectively zero. Everybody in this room, everybody who lives in an advanced industrial country, is walking around with on the order of 3 to 5 parts per trillion of dioxin in the body fat. That means you and you and you and me and everybody here. In the north of Vietnam, the levels are so low we can't detect them, or barely detect them. Whereas in the south of Vietnam, the levels are considerably higher in many people than they are in the background population in the United States. You thus have a people which is culturally homogeneous, right, of a single race as opposed to the multiracial American background, where we can study those who have higher levels and those who have lower levels. You can't do that here as well. Right? So that whatever we learn in Vietnam is going to be helpful, right, for the study of Vietnam veterans in the United States.
Thank you. Dr. Schichter, would the government of Vietnam be amenable to such a joint effort?
In my experience, the Ministry of Health has been extremely cooperative, as have the medical schools, hospitals, and regional health facilities. They have given remarkable cooperation on the 7 previous visits I've had to Vietnam.
I believe you refer to a study that you conducted of Massachusetts Vietnam veterans, and that finding a subset of veterans with high levels of dioxin in their blood. Yet the U.S. Centers for Disease Control says it's impossible to assess exposure in Vietnam veterans. Why were you able to do it, but CDC couldn't?
We feel that the percent of the 3 million people who served in Vietnam who this long afterwards, perhaps 20 years afterwards, still has elevated dioxin level from Agent Orange is probably not high. However, if you target appropriately and if you try your hardest to select people you think had high exposure, it's not particularly hard to use this technique with a number of nuances, considering half-life, considering the other dioxins, because, for example, if we're typical Americans, we have 1,200 parts per trillion total dioxins in our body. If for some reason the three of you up there are at the bottom of the average distribution, you might have 300 total. Another person might have 2,000. So you compare the dioxin of Agent Orange to the total dioxins. You have to look at everything. You have to look at the time after exposure. Was the Vietnam veteran very thin when he served in the jungles of Vietnam, and fat now? Is there a dilution? I don't think it's impossible to find a relatively large group in the thousands at least upon which to do health studies.
Could I add something? It should also be mentioned that in addition to blood testing for dioxin, which Dr. Schechter has done and we have done, there is the exposure index that was developed by the Stelmans in the Columbia University American Legion study, and that index works. And it's something that we could do now on large numbers of veterans. They have a vast amount of information that the Stelmans have assembled that could be used today in order to isolate groups of veterans whose exposure would be higher than the norm.
And that's, we're talking about, we're focusing on the best measure of exposure to Agent Orange we have right now, measuring dioxins in human tissues. But we shouldn't forget that there are other measures being developed that will be useful. There are oncogenes, there are protein adducts, there are other tools which may suggest who is at more risk for exposure to cancer. We're focusing on one tool. I think the point that Peter Kahn made, investigator-initiated research where you'll stake your life on trying to find results, is important because you don't want to have just top-down mandated studies. You need to have studies from various medical schools, various universities of people doing one or another kind of work. It's just as important in Vietnam veterans that if we can find oncogene activation suggesting there's going to be more cancer, whether it's from the 2,4-D or the dioxin, that we know about this to help veterans to have a better life and their family.
Before I let you get back to your normal pursuits with the gratitude of the subcommittee, there may be something that has come up in the course of questions asked to one or other of the panelists that you might want to comment on. So if any of you want to, yes, Dr. Tidebaum?
Mr. Chairman, since I live in an agricultural state and we have a large number of people who have been exposed to 2,4-D, certainly, and we haven't had the benefit of the kind of investigations that have been done in our neighbors in Kansas and Nebraska, I would certainly like to put in a word for looking at the American agricultural worker, particularly at our migrant workers who have very intense exposure and whose exposure can be characterized very well because the application rates are known, the materials used are known, and so on. And if a study is established which would look at the Vietnamese and at Vietnam veterans, I would certainly like to ask that similar studies be done of our own agricultural workers who bear a significant portion of this burden as well.
Dr. Horzam, anything to add?
Yes, I have one comment. Earlier today, Dr. Schechter asked a question. He said, if you don't believe these results or accept that there are some associations here between Agent Orange exposure, dioxin exposure, and these diseases, you know, what studies do you have to throw out? You know, what do you have to ignore? My question, I would rephrase it, and I'd say, what would it take to convince you? We have animal data that's positive. We have human studies that show dose-response relationships that are striking, and I think they're very convincing. And I just would ask for those who still doubt some of these findings, what's missing? What would it take to convince someone?
Let me give you an example of that. In animals, dioxin is an immunosuppressant. That statement is not controversial. You give dioxin to laboratory animals, their immune system goes kerflop. In humans, we now have associations between use of agricultural chemicals, right, and non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, among other conditions. People who receive organ transplants are given immunosuppressive drugs for obvious reasons, so that their bodies will not reject the transplant. And those people are 350 times more likely to contract a non-Hodgkin's lymphoma than the general population. So you've got three pieces of a triangle: immunosuppression in animals by dioxin, epidemiological associations between agricultural chemicals and non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, and a connection between immunosuppression and non-Hodgkin's lymphoma in humans. You are no less able than I, as a scientist, to say whether that's a coincidence or not.
Well, again, I want to thank each of you very much for sharing your expertise and your knowledge with us. This has been a long story in unraveling, but I think that we're getting to the point where, in fact, most of it is coming out, and you have our appreciation and gratitude for helping us in that process. Thank you.
You're welcome, sir. The VA witnesses walked out the door as soon as you announced the conclusion. As soon as you said to him, we have to close your silence. So I got up and you invited them on June 7th. They were well aware of this hearing. They were well aware of an all-day hearing.
How many people are here from the tour, right?
Meadows and Yanders left. Right. With the club and Silver.
Right.
So if you want to make any mention of this.
Right. We're now ready for our third and final panel, and that panel is scheduled to consist of Oliver Meadows, Chair of the Advisory Committee on Environmental Hazards, Department of Veterans Affairs, Dr. Armin Yanders, Chair, Scientific Council, Advisory Committee on Environmental Hazards, Department of Veterans Affairs, Richard W. Clapp, Dr. Clapp, Director of Environmental Health Studies, JSI Research and Training Institute, and Dr. Ellen K. Silbergeld, Senior Scientist at the Environmental Defense Fund. And if the panelists will come forward and stand behind their nameplates, two are here. My understanding is that just a matter of moments ago, the Veterans Affairs witnesses left. They had indicated to us earlier this morning that they had an unavoidable conflict because they're going to be deposing somewhere in Texas tomorrow. We've had this date set since the 7th of June. There is no excuse at all for that conflict to exist at this point. We will indeed be communicating with the Secretary of the department to get some understanding as to what the intention of the department is as far as getting these witnesses before us. If you'll raise your right hand, you swear or affirm the testimony you're about to give with the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth.
I do.
Thank you. Let the record indicate that each of the witnesses has responded in the affirmative. Again, we have your prepared statements, and those will be entered into the record in their entirety, and you can proceed as you will, so long as you don't take more than 10 minutes. Dr. Clapp, I think we'll begin with your testimony.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I had prepared a written statement, and in the interest of time, I know we've all been here for several hours and had a delay, I'd like to just summarize my written statement briefly, and then perhaps answer questions. Thank you for this opportunity to comment today on the federal government's analysis and interpretation of scientific research on chemical contaminants contained in herbicides such as Agent Orange. My name is Richard W. Clapp, and I am employed at a nonprofit organization called JSI Research and Training Institute in Boston, Massachusetts. I'm director of an environmental health studies group there. I have a doctoral degree in epidemiology and have been the director of the Massachusetts Cancer Registry for most of the decade of the 80s, in which capacity I conducted studies of the pattern of cancer in Vietnam veterans in Massachusetts. I have testified before another committee of Congress earlier this spring on Veterans Affairs, and I think the transcript from that might be available, and I won't repeat a lot of what I said at that. I'd like to just briefly comment on the Centers for Disease Control study that was released earlier this spring called the Association of Selected Cancers with Military Service in U.S. military in Vietnam. I attended a briefing by the principal investigator and some of the authors of that study on March 29th, and I have had subsequent discussions with some of the individuals involved. This was a large study, I believe the largest of this type of Vietnam veterans in the U.S., a case control study. It did report, as been said earlier today, a statistically significant association between service in Vietnam and non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, but declined to draw the conclusion that that might be due to Agent Orange exposure. My understanding of why the authors took this position was that with looking at specific subgroups within the study, there were inconsistencies as to subgroups that did not appear to have elevated risk and others that did. I find these interpretations and their explanation of these interpretations very unsatisfying, and both as a scientist and also considering the enormous level of funding and effort that went into this study. It was initially intended to have dioxin levels measured either from blood or fat samples. That was discontinued as the study proceeded. The exposure index has been indicated already this morning was abandoned along the way. So all was what was left at the end was the general category of service in Vietnam and then specific location of service or branch of service and that type of thing for analysis. Given a $10 million budget, I find this extremely unrewarding. And unfortunately, this is not the first time that the Centers for, or specifically the CDC Center for Environmental Health and Injury Control has left citizens and veterans and independent scientists feeling this way. The leadership of the center in particular, Dr. Vernon Hauck, who has been named earlier today, has had a reputation of underinterpreting and underestimating the human health effects of exposure to a number of environmental toxins, of which dioxin is perhaps the most troubling. But he has also a previous record of conflict with independent scientists over the health effects of exposure to lead in children, low levels of lead. And I find this continuing pattern troublesome, to say the least. Just briefly to comment on the latest research links, the task force report that was entitled Human Health Effects Associated with Exposure to Herbicides and or Their Associated Contaminants, Chlorinated Dioxins, Agent Orange and the Vietnam Veteran, that's the full name of the report, was submitted earlier this year to Congress. I hope you have a copy. If not, I'll be glad to make one available for you or the members of your committee. And in that report, we reviewed, I was a member of the task force that put that report together. We reviewed the published literature up to the spring, and we concluded that there was strong scientific evidence associating phenoxyacetic acid, herbicides, and or their associated contaminants, dioxins in particular, with non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, soft tissue sarcoma, chloracne, subclinical hepatotoxic effects, and porphyria cutanea tarda. This last and most likely in individuals with an inherited enzyme deficiency. And there was evidence from the literature of other diseases and conditions, including birth defects and neurological effects, but the data was not as strong as for these five conditions or diseases that I've named. There are also recent studies. Dr. Horazam has cited some from the National Cancer Institute, the results of which have been published recently or are about to be published. Some also in the Swedish, from the Swedish investigators, Dr. Hardell, Erickson, and others, and a recent Canadian study, all pointing in the same direction, which is an association with phenoxyherbicide acetic acid, phenoxyacetic acid herbicide substances, and both non-Hodgkin's lymphoma and soft tissue sarcoma. I've just recently had a study that I conducted in Massachusetts accepted for publication, which again will show a connection between Vietnam service and soft tissue sarcoma in Massachusetts veterans. And I would say that the evidence is overwhelming at this point, and it's still coming in. So I would reiterate Dr. Horazam's question, what would it take to convince somebody at this point that these substances do cause cancer and other diseases in human beings? I think it's inescapable. And finally, I'd just like to offer two recommendations to the Subcommittee on Future Studies. The first is to continue the support from federal sources of the National Cancer Institute studies of herbicide workers, agricultural workers, and others, and also the NIOSH, National Institute for Occupational Safety and Health studies of dioxin workers, in particular their dioxin workers registry. I think that poses a unique opportunity to follow up United States and I believe also other international workers who are explicitly exposed to dioxin and to see what the health effects are that can be documented from that unique opportunity. And these individuals, Dr. Horzam and Dr. Blair in particular at the NCI and Dr. Fingerhut at NIOSH, have a proven track record that is trusted in the independent scientific community. And I would recommend, secondly, that another Vietnam veterans selected cancer study be undertaken at a later time. This is partly because of the unsatisfying quality of the first study, but also because the what's called the latency period between initial exposure to some substance that may cause cancer and the development of that disease may actually be longer for some of these cancers than has been looked at in this initial selected cancer study. And that's, I think, particularly true with liver cancer. Looking at the incidence of liver cancer in Vietnam veterans might better be done sometime later, perhaps 5 years from now. At this point, I have no recommendation about how that later study might be conducted, but unless the leadership of the Centers for Environmental Health and Injury Control changes at the CDC, I think that would not be a good place for that follow-up study to be conducted. Thank you for the opportunity to make these comments to your committee.
Thank you very much, Dr. Clapp. I understand that you have a plane you'd like to catch, and I've got just a couple of questions I'm going to ask you, and then if you like, you can take off and see if you can make your connection.
Okay? Thank you.
Last January, CDC issued a study of selected cancers which found that Vietnam veterans were at elevated risk of only one cancer, non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. You testified that the CDC selected cancer study, quote, underinterpreted their own findings. On what do you base that conclusion?
I think I'll read some of the conclusions that the CDC authors gave at the briefing. They cite that the risk is not significantly higher for those men with greater potential for exposure to Agent Orange. This is from their briefing report, 30-page report, the last page. Those with greater opportunity for exposure, they list as men, in parentheses, men serving in three corps, men in combat units, men in shore and brown water Navy, and Army veterans. And yet from their table, specifically summarizing these data with respect to non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, there's a finding with respect to I Corps. And in our experience in Massachusetts, talking to veterans, we have the same experience as Dr. Khan has. We've learned a lot from talking with veterans. I Corps is definitely an area of significant Agent Orange exposure for those who were stationed there. And in the CDC report of the corps in Vietnam, the relative risk in I Corps is the highest of any. They keep focusing in their written report and in their comments on three corps, which has a slightly lower than expected relative risk compared to the controls. I Corps, on the other hand, is the highest of that whole group, and they are silent on that in their report and in their oral comments about it. And I believe that that's a finding that should be highlighted, and it's important to point that out. Furthermore, in this same table, risk of non-Hodgkin's lymphoma among subgroups of men with military service, they point out that duration of service in Vietnam in years can be broken down in this table in four ways. And there's an increasing trend of risk of non-Hodgkin's lymphoma with increasing service in Vietnam. And it's not quite statistically significant, they say, but it's a trend, a clear trend in the data. And I feel they underinterpret or underestimate the importance of that finding as well.
You are a member, as you said, of the Agent Orange Scientific Task Force.
Yes.
The task force found strong evidence of the relationship between phenoxy herbicides like Agent Orange and non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, soft tissue sarcoma, chloracne, subclinical hepatotoxic effects, and pruritus cutanea tarda. What is your evidence and how strong is it?
Well, the evidence is from the review of the published literature. And most of those articles that we reviewed, it was over 300 articles, were in peer-reviewed journals. So we culled the world literature, basically, for the evidence from studies done in Scandinavia and other parts of the European community and United States. And our assessment of the strength of the evidence led us to those conclusions.
Again, you have my appreciation, that of the subcommittee. And we very much appreciate you taking time from your very hectic schedule to be with us.
Thank you very much.
Dr. Silbergeld, you're going to be our wind-up witness.
Thank you very much. I'll try not to take too much time. The substance of my testimony today on your invitation concerns the latest research findings and their implications for drawing associations between exposure specifically to dioxin and human disease. I've attached to my testimony a recent scientific review upon which I will draw in presenting this testimony. As we know from listening to this testimony today, the health effects of Agent Orange remain contentious. The subcommittee deserves our commendation for the tenacity and depth of understanding with which it has pursued over the past several years the issue of federal involvement in research on Agent Orange. The story of this involvement over the past decade does not do very great credit to the government's ability to separate science from politics or to utilize the best science to reach important policy decisions. Biomedical research on dioxin has focused on several critical issues. Among these are the qualitative nature and dose response of specific toxic effects of dioxin in appropriate animal models, the evaluation of exposure, including but not limited to measuring dioxin in lipid compartments, epidemiological data on health effects in dioxin-exposed populations, and the mechanisms of action of dioxin at the subcellular level. as well as the implications of those for assessing the risk of dioxin for humans. With respect to the first area, it's probably the case that we know more about the range of toxic effects of dioxin and related compounds than for almost any other chemical of concern in the environment. There is substantial literature demonstrating that TCDD and other dioxins and related compounds such as dibenzofurans are toxic to many organ systems. The plenipotent nature of dioxin, that is, its ability to affect many different sites at relatively low doses, has long challenged our understanding as to how one molecule could act in so many different ways. And thus, much of recent research has focused on identifying the initial cellular events that may be common to the expression of this range of toxicity. Although many of these effects have been most clearly demonstrated in animals other than humans, the numbers of species studied and the existence of confirmatory epidemiologic data for certain effects increases the weight that should be given to these well-conducted experimental studies. Now, with respect to dose response, this has remained a very contentious issue in many areas of discussion about dioxin. In fact, for most of the effects of dioxin, we really have not explored a full range of doses in order to determine what that dose response might be. And also, much depends on how we define effect. For instance, in reproductive studies, most of these studies have looked at structural abnormalities as the endpoint of effect, even in the human studies, although we know that TCDD will induce significant physiological abnormalities in fetuses at lower doses. And for instance, in the birth defects study done by CDC, it was noted, although no data were given, that there was a higher incidence of neonatal cancer in children born to Vietnam-era veterans. And this is the kind of effect that would not be immediately cataloged or observed by looking at structural abnormalities presenting at birth. Much has been made over the past years of purported differences among species in terms of dose response. Now, a difference that's often pointed to is the acutely lethal dose of dioxin, which appears to vary by as much as 1,000-fold across species tested. But we should keep in mind that the lethal dose for dioxin is relatively low compared to most other toxic agents for all species tested. It's sometimes claimed that humans are completely resistant to dioxin lethality. It's more likely that we have very little experience of the doses that would be required, and I provide such a calculation for you in my testimony. In fact, there may have been as many as 2 or 3 acute lethalities among the BASF workforce involved in cleaning up after the process accident in 1953. One thing that is very important is straightening out the available industrial epidemiologic data. The second major area of research has concerned ascertainment of exposure. As other witnesses today have pointed out, this is of critical importance given that most of our assessment of health effects in humans depends upon epidemiologic analysis of populations sometime after the fact of exposure and in situations where information on past exposure is rather imprecise. Moreover, as Dr. Schechter pointed out, since all of us on this planet are exposed to dioxin, it's very important to be able to measure different degrees of exposure with some degree of precision. It would be very useful to have a marker of dioxin exposure that relates to concentrations of dioxin at critical sites of action, analogous to DNA adducts for certain other chemicals. But at present, we don't have this. The third and most contentious area of research is focused on epidemiologic studies. I won't discuss this area. Other witnesses here with great expertise have discussed this. I would point out, however, that the federal government has unique access to 2 major epidemiologic cohorts, the Vietnam veterans, including Ranch Hand, and the NIOSH worker cohort assembled from industry reporting. The chemical industry has unique access to other cohorts, groups of workers employed in processes known to have caused the generation of dioxins. Outside the United States, there are several groups with more or less well-characterized exposure for which epidemiologic data should be accumulated, and they may prove to be very useful sources of unbiased studies. Of them, the most important are the Yushou and Yucheng population, 2 groups in Japan and China, exposed to dibenzofurans via ingestion of contaminated cooking oil. Studies on these 2 populations to date have already yielded information associating exposure with developmental and reproductive problems, immune dysfunction, and cancer. Other populations that should be studied more vigorously with international cooperation are the Seveso population, the Australian Vietnam veterans, and, as Dr. Schechter mentioned, the Vietnamese people. Also, studies of paper mill workers may be useful if dioxin exposures can be precisely determined for this group. And I would note a recent publication that just came out reporting excess cancer incidents in one such cohort. Research on mechanisms of action of dioxin has been one of the most exciting and potentially valuable areas of research over the past 15 years. The identification and explanation of a specific protein which exists in human and other cells has done a great deal in furthering our understanding as to how dioxin produces a large number of its effects and why, in fact, it is so potent. We now understand that dioxin, while it does not act directly on nuclear genetic material, after binding to its specific receptor within cells, is translocated to the cell nucleus, where, in fact, it associates with specific genes and alters the expression of neighboring genes. In some instances, this effect results in increased transcription of genes, such as those encoding for production of certain enzymes, hence one of the characteristic effects of dioxin exposure, enzyme induction. And in other cases, this association may result in decreased gene transcription. This is extremely important because there is an important working hypothesis current for the induction of cancer as the coordinate enhancement of tumor-producing genes, such as oncogenes, and the suppression of tumor suppressor genes. Now, the importance of this mechanistic research is several-fold. First, it allows us to develop a molecular basis for understanding how dioxin causes its extraordinary range of effects. Second, it permits us to compare the actions of dioxin at the molecular level in cells from humans as well as other organisms. And it's important to note that we know that the molecular machinery, the dioxin receptor, and dioxin-responsive elements on the gene exist in human cells. To what extent the rate of gene translation and post-translational factors differ among species is not known, but this research provides directions for exploring these important issues. Third, this research permits the rational extension of toxicity evaluation and risk assessment from TCDD to many other structurally similar compounds, including other dioxins, dibenzofurans, PCBs, PBBs, and some of the compounds that Dr. Teitelbaum mentioned earlier, which bear extraordinary structural resemblance to dioxins. In fact, I might note parenthetically, it is extraordinary that the Congress of the United States has not compelled the Environmental Protection Agency to take the same actions against polybrominated biphenyls as it has against polychlorinated biphenyls. Finally, this research provides a rational basis for assessing the risks of dioxin at the molecular level, and in fact may allow us to use a more sophisticated approach to risk assessment in a variety of environmental and occupational settings where dioxins occur. Nevertheless, at present, it's important to state that an expert peer review panel of the EPA found that there is no scientific justification at present to support utilization of an alternate method for risk assessment of dioxin or the derivation of alternate and lower estimates of risk to humans. I'd like to conclude with indicating some of the areas of research that were identified by an industry-convened panel on which I served, called to identify such critical areas of research in this contentious issue. These are the identification of dioxin-responsive genes and the kinetics of dioxin and cellular response, immunotoxic effects of dioxin, neurotoxic effects of dioxin, sources and exposures to dioxin analogs, improved assessment of the relative risks of different dioxins and related compounds, the ecological effects of dioxins, particularly in fish, the effects of dioxins on estrogen receptors, and identifying the endogenous regulator of the dioxin receptor. With respect to federal research on dioxin, at present, there is no coordinated program for integrated research on these important topics. Funding for dioxin research is allocated on a project-by-project basis with no interagency coordination or consideration as to how specific research projects might be integrated into improving risk assessment or reaching important policy decisions. The Veterans Administration had a university-based research program several years ago, but it was defunded when the federal government decided that Agent Orange was a non-issue. The NIOSH worker study, which I support as Dr. Clapp did, has, however, mysteriously shrunk its cohort from thousands to hundreds of subjects. ATSDR has failed to establish an effective dioxin registry at Superfund sites. Now, unfortunately, the government is one of the entities with a great deal at stake on the outcome of research on dioxin, basic as well as epidemiological. This subcommittee would perform an important service, as Dr. Khan mentioned, if it can determine how to disentangle the interests of government in policymaking on dioxin, including the compensation of veterans, from the role of government in funding and conducting research on dioxin. One of the important contributions that government could make to resolving these controversies is through increased coordinated funding of critical research, including participation in international epidemiologic studies. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Silvergeld. And we very much appreciate your patience and your perseverance in staying with us. You're on the HHS advisory panel on ranch hand studies. We recently received a copy of a draft birth defect report prepared by the Air Force. The study was incomplete at the time, but concluded that the incidence of birth defects in ranch hand personnel increased after service in Vietnam. 6 years later, the study has still not been completed. Do you have any idea why this study had been delayed?
No direct information has certainly been given to us, nor, in fact, have we been given that study to review as an advisory committee.
The states of Georgia and Virginia have weakened their dioxin dumping standards for waterways. Other states are considering following suit. Some states claim there is new evidence that dioxin is not as dangerous as once thought. Is there any new scientific evidence to support weakening dioxin dumping standards?
No, there is not. There have been many allusions made in the popular press from interested parties that there exists some body of new data. What most of these allusions are to is a reassessment sponsored by industry, conducted by Dr. Robert Squire, of the old slides from a Dow Chemical study, one of the first studies to show that TCDD could cause cancer in animals. This group with industry funding reexamined these slides and reportedly has found that some of the lesions that were formerly considered to be malignant tumors are benign tumors. Now, the exact nature and status of that reexamination has not been revealed to the scientific community through the normal course of events through publication in a peer-reviewed journal, but in no event can this be considered new information. What you point to, this state-by-state confusion, which ends up with such bizarre events with the state of Virginia having different standards from the state of Maryland, yet both impacting on the same waterway, the Potomac River, to me demonstrates a very troubling lack of leadership by EPA. I don't understand why this nation does not have one consistent water standard for dioxin. In fact, such a standard was developed by EPA, but has never been promulgated with any kind of force.
Last year, you testified before the subcommittee that the White House, particularly OMB, had been interfering with the progress of dioxin studies involving worker exposure. Have you seen any signs of the situation improving under the new administration?
Well, there's no new funding been allocated to NIOSH, and as I mentioned in my testimony, it's very troubling when a group of subjects shrinks drastically, because one of the most important issues in any epidemiologic study is getting as many people as you can into the study. That's what increases your ability to see any possible association, any change in frequency. To lose by tenfold the number of workers that were originally referred to this study is a very, very troubling event and weakens from the start the ability or power of this study to reach any conclusion. One justification for this shrinkage, I understand, has been a defunding of the NIOSH study. If that's the case, Congress should look into this immediately, because this is an extremely valuable source of information.
In light of political interference in dioxin studies, do you think agencies such as NIOSH and NCI are still the best places to have research conducted?
I think those can be excellent places to have research conducted, but as Dr. Khan mentioned, I think that experience with biomedical research in this country has indicated that a free market is our best way at ascertaining the truth, rapidly and efficiently, and that funds should be available for university-based and other types of research also to be conducted.
How relevant is the presence of dioxin in the environment to the increase in non-Hodgkin's lymphoma in the United States?
It's very difficult to determine that on a national basis. It would probably be very interesting, taking some of the studies that NCI is compiling, to look at year-to-year changes in herbicide use and compare those with year-to-year changes with the diagnosis of cancer.
Well, again, I thank you very much for your participation, your contribution to the work of this subcommittee over a period of years. That winds up with the testimony for today. The testimony that we've heard, I think, should be troubling to all Americans. It is quite clear that the conclusions driven by the federal government do not, in regard to veterans' compensation for dioxin exposure and resultant illnesses in Vietnam, are not related at all to the scientific studies that have been completed. And it is, I think, nothing short of shameful that a country as great as ours, which asks young American men and women, for the most part, to risk their lives and to give their lives in many instances, to then use a judgment on compensation or cost to deny compensation for illnesses or injury acquired. It belies, it seems to me, all the flag waving that goes on. The true test, it seems to me, of how much you care is how you treat the people you've put at risk. And the testimony goes, of course, even beyond veterans in Vietnam. It goes to the very question as to the extent to which there's a cover-up or lack of pursuit of the great risk that all Americans, but especially those who utilize herbicides, are put to. We will be continuing this hearing to get the testimony of the Environmental Advisory Committee of the Department of Veterans Affairs. I do not understand the conduct of the witnesses who were scheduled to testify today, who appeared and who for the first time gave us notice today that they had a conflict which could not be avoided.
They told us yesterday.
Yesterday was the first time that they notified us of it. It is not often that we have to threaten to use subpoenas to get federal witnesses before us, and I'm hopeful that that will in fact not be necessary in this case either. But I would like to think that when the Secretary reviews what happened to the witnesses from his who were associated with his department today, that he will be as unhappy about it as we are. The subcommittee now stands adjourned, subject to the call of the chair.
If you would like further information about this hearing, you can contact the House Government Operations Subcommittee on Human Resources and Intergovernmental Relations. The offices are located in room B372 of the Rayburn Office Building, Washington, D.C. The zip code is 20515. Coming up next, a discussion of travel restrictions for those infected with the HIV virus.